Ambassador Dr. Michael Oren, although he's asked to be just called Michael this evening, is an American-born Israeli historian, military officer, author, and was Israel's ambassador to the United States from 2009 to 2013. In Israel's 2015 election, he was elected to the Knesset for the Kulanu Party. He has, of course, written two New York Times bestselling books about the Middle East, and his new memoir, Ally, My Journey Across the American-Israeli Divide, is an account of his time as ambassador and his insider's perspective on the relationship between America and Israel. Janine Zacharia, formerly the Jerusalem bureau chief of the Washington Post, is the Carlos Kelly McClatchy visiting lecturer at Stanford University. She will be in conversation with Michael tonight. Please welcome them both to Canbar Hall.
How's everybody doing?
Good.
All right. Welcome to the JCC. Thank you to the JCC for inviting me to moderate this discussion and sit with Michael Oren, who I've known for a long time. I actually have memories of sitting with you in 2005 on a rock in the Gaza Strip. You were dressed in your Miluim reservist uniform, guiding the foreign press about the disengagement. Do you remember that?
But what happened?
They disengaged.
No, we were sitting on a lawn.
Oh.
This, you can't make this up. We're sitting on a lawn, and there was a tree, which was an old
tree. Remember the tree.
And all of a sudden, part of the tree collapsed and just missed us, which could be interpreted as divine intervention or divine dissension. But I've never seen anything like it. The tree just fell on us. You remember that.
I remember. Now that you mention it, I remember the tree.
Right.
But I had forgotten it somehow. Yeah. I was a little distracted. It was a little bit of a busy time.
Yeah.
So let me talk a little bit about how this is going to work. I'm going to ask Michael questions about a variety of subjects, and let me just give you a sense of the scope of what I'm going to try and do. Michael's written a very incisive, I think it's fair to say now, controversial book, which I've read and marked up in the margins here, called Ally. I'm going to draw from it, but I want to use it to have a conversation not only about the past, but also hopefully be able to look forward in terms of, to use him as an analyst on American-Israeli relations. And to that end, we're going to discuss his critique of President Obama, try and, as we have a historian here, put that in some historical context comparatively. We're going to talk about Jews tonight. And we're going to talk about American Jews and how Michael sees the role of the American Jewish community. There are parts of the American Jewish community that he has a more favorable view of now after being ambassador than others, and that comes through in the book. Jewish journalists, which some of you may have read, has created a little bit of a stir, what he has said about Jewish journalists. We're going to talk about the Palestinians and the future of the peace process, Bibi Netanyahu. There's a lot to get to, is the point. And we're going to try and do that all and maybe try and solve the Israeli-Palestinian conflict.
About 2,000 years.
I don't know. Iran, yeah. Don't forget Iran. Yeah. Yeah. Something's going to have to give, but I'm going to try to get to as much of it as I can in the Q&A, and then I will be taking your questions and trying to get to as many of those as possible. Sound good? So, Michael, when I was reading your book, I was thinking about one word. I thought of the word disconnect. And I want to get your sense on my take on this, that there's a disconnect in the way Israel sees itself and the world and the United States primarily perhaps see Israel. And the disconnect is two versions of reality. Here's version one. Strappy little Israel, born out of the ashes of the Holocaust, threatened with another potential Holocaust by maybe an Iranian nuclear weapon, surrounded by an unprecedentedly radical, disintegrating Middle East, with only one ally and maybe perhaps an uncertain ally, if we take your book as the way you've written it, that needs to do what it needs to do to defend the Jewish people. Okay, that's version one. Version two, and this is my read of it, so I want to get Michael to comment on it. One of the strongest militaries on the planet, Israel, backed by the strongest country in the world, is occupying another people, building settlements, very often fighting with this protector, the United States, publicly, which is something that a lot of people in America have been confused by, I think, and I want to focus a lot on that, and unable or unwilling to reach a peace deal with the Palestinians. So I see this as two different versions. And I'm sure there are people in the audience who maybe agree with one or the other, and frankly, it doesn't matter, but I think
there's
two versions. Or both, maybe. Maybe there's a way to do both. But yeah. I think, for me, these two versions is what creates and underlies a lot of the tensions that you describe in your book, and I just wanted to use that as a starting point.
Fine. Terrific. Very good. First of all, shalom, everyone, JCC, San Francisco. Yeah. There was a time a couple years ago, 20 years ago, where I would know or be related to just about everybody in this room through my wife, Sally, who by the way, she says, when I chose this title, I knew it was going to be one word with two syllables. She said, well, you're going to have this, and everyone's going to say you left out the S. So for the record, I didn't leave out the S. So she appears rather prominently. I think it's an excellent opening question, the image of Israel, because I would take issue with some of the words you use. I don't think that Israel occupies the homeland of the Jewish people. I do think we rule over 2.5 million Palestinians, and we can get to that later, what I think we should do about that. But I think both of those... Both of those generalities, they're both right. Yes, the IDF is over twice as large as the British and French armies combined. It's the second largest citizens' armies in the world. It is highly motivated, technologically sophisticated. And yes, Israel faces threats that are not faced by any other government or country today. Thinking back through history, it's almost unparalleled. Because when the leaders of Israel wake up in the morning, they face 100,000 rockets in the hands of Hezbollah. And by the way, that's more rockets than that are possessed by NATO. And they can hit every city in the state of Israel, and we don't necessarily have a defense against all of them. We are facing a Middle East that is unraveling around us. We face the situation in Gaza. We face delegitimization in international forum and an Iranian nuclear program, which is not one but several existential threats, all at the same time. And in our relationship with the United States, yes, and this is what the book is about, the ally, we have, in many ways, the ultimate alliance, where there's no substitute for America, for Israel, that just happens to be the world's largest military superpower, also the largest democracy, which happens to be our ally, which does provide us with essential security aid and stands up for us in international forums. The United States has no alternative to Israel, certainly not in the Middle East, because you have a country that's technologically and scientifically, certainly militarily robust. It has never known a second of non-democratic governance, which puts us in a very narrow category in the world with like New Zealand and Australia and Canada. And a country which is unreservedly, unabashedly pro-American. We're not burning American flags in the streets of Tel Aviv. Really, there's no substitute. So we have together. And with that, as the book is very express in saying, we have divides. We have differences, sometimes very deep differences, over the peace process, over settlements, over the status of Jerusalem, and now, today, most poignantly, most publicly, Iran. And this book, which was supposed to have come out in October, November, which is when you publish nonfiction books, if you want to make a big splash, you don't bring out a nonfiction book in the beach reading season. Poor people at Random House, they couldn't understand why I wanted to bring out in June. I wanted to bring up June because of the Iran issue. I said, if you really want to worry about changing the name, you know, they all remember Jaws. Remember Jaws, 1970? That was the ultimate beach book. I said, we can change the name of the book to Jews. Okay? A little phylactery going, no one will go in the water while reading this thing. The answer is both, and I think you're right, Janine. I think you're right that this is the tension in the book. And it would give it part of its motive power. And as an ambassador, it's how I got all the gray hair, because it wasn't easy to span the divides.
And you yourself in the book seem to go back and forth a little bit. I mean, there are moments where you do acknowledge both of these realities. I think you do tend to favor more the first reality. I mean, you talk personally about growing up with facing anti-Semitism. You reflect often and regularly about the Holocaust. So those things are clearly foremost in your mind. You talk about when you want Israel to be perceived as the good guy, but when you put on a uniform, you know, you'll fight and fight to defend the country and safeguard it. So talk about that tension for you, though, and how it played out.
It was intensely personal. Mm-hmm. We talked before, back in the green room, what it was like for me to go from being an historian who wrote in the third person to being a person who writes a memoir and has to write in the first person. And this is a very difficult transformation. You said that you went through it too. Writing in the first person, who are you? And how do you begin to separate your personal experiences and perspectives from a broader historical context, an overview? And for me, I'll tell you right now, it's difficult. I was in the military for something like 35 years, several wars. Our eldest son was wounded in action, shot by Hamas at close range. Sally, many of you know, lost her sister in a suicide bombing attack. We've been rocketed, we've been bombed. So the image of a beleaguered, besieged Israel is one that I've internalized on a very visceral level, you can imagine. Other aspects of it, the political delegitimization, what we do to help precipitate that, and we do things that do help precipitate it, with some of our policies, and I've taken public issue with those policies, are much more abstract than, you know, seeing your son's bloody, bullet-ridden uniform on the floor of the emergency room at Hadassah Medical Center. That's powerful stuff. I went to identify my sister-in-law's body. That's powerful stuff. That impacts the way you think. Last summer, while writing this book, I had to keep on running from my office into our bomb shelter in Tel Aviv because barrage after barrage of rockets are coming in.
So yeah, I want to spend some time, we're going to spend some time on last summer, especially since there are now rockets again, and I think we should talk about that. So one of the other things that I had in mind as I was reading it was the Israeli phrase, an old song, and it's a popular phrase, Ha'olam kulo negdenu. The whole world is against us. It doesn't matter what we'll do. I'm paraphrasing the rest. The whole world will be against us. Is this your outlook?
First of all, empirically, it's not true. When you say the whole world, even the people who say the world is against us, it's a very strange definition of the world. Does it include Western Europe or parts of Western Europe? Yeah. South America, parts of South America? Yeah. But it seems to me there's like 1.3 billion Chinese who rather like us. And just over a billion Indians who kind of like us. And between 70 and 74% of Americans like us. So the world is, you know, I think it's a rather narrow, how should I say, definition of what the world is. But I don't think that. And I also think that, yes, there are parts of the world that are against us and will remain sort of irredeemably against us. I think we have a real problem with Europe, and that's a problem that didn't begin with the state of Israel. It didn't even begin with Christianity. It actually predated Christianity and made out now just post-date Christianity. But I think that we can take steps that will, in certain ways, you know, mitigate some of those policies that threaten us. Let's put a specific title. We're threatened now with boycotts and sanctions, particularly from Europe. And I'm strong of the opinion that Israel should work to make it difficult for them. As I'm in politics now, and I was had the privilege of designing my party's diplomatic platform. It was a big incentive for me to join this party. And I'm strongly in favor of limiting where Israel builds in Judea, Samaria, the West Bank, to only those areas that will be part of a Jewish state in any future two-state solution. Even if it doesn't look like we're going to get that two-state solution. Well, it's okay. You can clap. It's fine. I'll pause. It's not an easy policy to adopt, but it is formally my policy. I wrote an article a couple months ago in the Wall Street Journal called The Two-State Situation, which says, what do we do if we don't have a two-state solution right now? How should Israel act? To preserve ourselves as a democratic and Jewish Israel, on one hand, but also defend ourselves against boycotts and sanctions. And I think sometimes we make it easier. We're dealing with BDS all the time. And boycott, divestment, sanctions, I'm sure you've heard of it. It's an international movement. It's very well funded and directed. And it is not about Israel, the situation after 67. It's about Israel, the situation after 1948. It's not designed to get a better two-state solution. It's designed to take us down. But
and
BDS
sure
will use...
I don't know if everybody would say that, Michael. It's designed to take you down?
Yes. I'm...
You don't think there's
worth,
nobody in the BDS movement that sees it differently? It's designed to take it down? You mean like destroy the state?
No, she's making a valid point. Hold up.
There is
Let me
a
defend Janine. Okay? Let me defend Janine. You're making a very valid point. Not everybody involved in BDS is trying to take down Israel. That's what I'm trying to get to. BDS will often pose as an organization that's anti-settlement. I can point to websites and say, you're against settlements, you want a Palestinian state, join us. But if you look at who's funding it, who's doing this, these are people who are not about two-state solution. They're about a one-state solution, which includes Israel's dissolution. That's what BDS is. And to understand that, I'm against making it hard on BDS. Let's not give them a tool to use against us. Let's make it tough for them. And so that's where I'm taking it. I think there are many people who cooperate with BDS not knowing what BDS really is.
So examples of that, what you were saying, were limiting construction to blocks of territory that, as you frequently say, everyone understands will remain part of a two-state solution.
Europe does not accept the formula that was set out by George Bush and Eric Sharon in 2004, the Bush-Sharon letter, and which I want to revive, and which said that the settlement blocks, 85% of the settlers are in these blocks. The blocks are about 2% of the West Bank and the Jewish neighborhoods of Jerusalem. And if you look at the Pally Weeks, this is the stuff that leaked out about the negotiations between Ehud Olmert and Mahmoud Abbas in 2007 and 8, you see that the Palestinians were willing to give up these areas. And what I stress in the book was that by not standing by the Bush-Sharon letter, and by the way, here, we more or less, strange bedfellows. The Obama administration, when it came into office, disavowed the letter, but Israel didn't stick by it. So what we did is, essentially, without getting into too much detail, we erased the difference between building, say, a balcony in Gilo, in Jerusalem, and building a settlement in far-flung Samaria, Itamar. We erased that difference. But that not only hurt Israel, it also hurt the Palestinians. What did it do? Bush-Sharon created space. And in diplomacy, I've learned you need space. So the Israeli government may feel compelled to build something. Maybe there's a terrorist attack. You have public opinion. But you don't want to build in Samaria. Maybe you want to build in Maale Adumim, if you know where this is, outside of Jerusalem. And that, you know, lets off steam. And if the Palestinians can say, okay, they're building in Maale Adumim, but we're going to continue negotiating, that's good. But what was created is a situation starting in 2009 where the Palestinians could not be less Palestinian than the President of the United States. And if the President of the United States was not distinguishing between building in Gilo and building in Itamar, then Mahmoud Abbas couldn't do it. And he said it. He gave it an interview to your old paper, to the Washington Post, where he said that the President basically put me up a tree,
right,
and then he kicked away the ladder. That's who he's referring to. It's just what he was referring to. So it took away space. And just tactically, if you want to get ahead on peace, it wasn't a good movement. Hillary Clinton now has written about it in her memoirs as well and said it was not a good idea. Not a good, it's quite irrespective of what you may think about settlements, but if you wanted to see the process move, everybody needs space.
You know, Olmert and Abbas, they were talking about it. They were actually talking, okay, what's going to happen around Ariel? What's going to happen here? But I don't know, has the Prime Minister ever actually been clear about what the blocks mean, what would happen with places like Ariel?
Not.
And do you think he should be?
I think he should be. But so that's my position. He had a meeting several weeks ago with the European Union's foreign minister. Lovely person, Mogherini, former Italian foreign minister. And she came out of that meeting very upbeat, and she said, I just heard more or less from the prime minister, that's what the spin in the paper was, that he's willing to go back basically to the former of Bush-Sharon. Israel's only going to build in the blocks and in Jewish Jerusalem. And I got very excited about this. I went on Israeli television, but I went on with a number member of the coalition from Habayit Yehudi, the Jewish Home Party, which also, it denies the difference between building in Gilo and building in Itamar. And I came out and strongly supported this approach, but my colleague from across the aisle, as they say in the Congress, was virulently against it and intimated that this would cause a coalition crisis if this was it. So you should know that this is not a position that, I don't know, I think it's widely accepted in Israel, but there are strong constituents in Israel that oppose it. But keep in mind, in April 2014, When John Kerry, the Secretary of State's peace process, collapsed, he spoke before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and he said, the Israelis built 700 units in a settlement and the process went poof. Remember this? The poof line. I spent 12 hours on Israeli television trying to find the Hebrew equivalent to the word poof. It's not there. Where was the settlement? Where did Israel announce the building of 700 units? In Gilo. Which no Israeli thinks is of a settlement, really. across the board. No one thinks of it.
My no Israeli Jew, grew, maybe.
Maybe Israeli Palestinians, maybe. I don't even know where Gilo is, but you know, here, my kids grew up across the street from Gilo, right, in Talpiot, which was always part of Israel. They didn't think Gilo was a 60,000 people. And so that's an argument that's very hard to make to to Israelis, that this is a settlement and this stops the process. It's also, last point on this, it's an impossible demand to make of any Israeli leader, left, right, up or down. Why? Explains this in the book. The West Bank has a certain status under Israeli law. It's not sovereign Israeli territory. But East Jerusalem, former Jordanian Jerusalem, in July of 1967 was formally annexed by Israel. It is sovereign Israeli territory. The Prime Minister of Israel has no more authority to freeze building in Jerusalem than the President of the United States has to freeze building in San Francisco. So it's an impossible demand to make. It ain't going to happen. And you can try to slow things down. You can try to give the Americans a sense of when these big projects are going to be announced. But if the Prime Minister tries to do that, he'll be hauled before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court will find against him. It's against Israeli law. So you have to be careful. If you're going into a peace process, don't make demands of the party that not only constrict their maneuverability, but which are impossible. And this is what happened.
Did you see a pattern when relations were perhaps getting a little bit better, though, between the United States and Israel, and then there would be an announcement of this kind of X number of units, and then the State Department would criticize, and then you'd have to get on the phone, and then there would have to, and then there would be a cycle. So even, yes, if what you just said is true, was there a sense that, oh my God, this is just repeating itself, and maybe we just need to figure out a way to avoid these kinds of clashes all the time?
I agree with you. I know, is that a question? I talk about in the book about some of these announcements about settlements. At the end of the book, and this doesn't get a lot of play in the press because it's not controversial, but the end of the book ends with a prescription. There's a couple of pages where I say, okay, you've now seen how we got to this point where, and not a particularly felicitous point in the relationship. How do we get out of here? How do we move forward? And among my prescriptions is that Israel, when it makes any decision, should always factor in what is the American interest, what is the American reaction, and how does this look through American eyes? Because the way superpowers see things is different the way a small regional power see things. How does it impact the American Jewish community? We're going to talk about this later. And that doesn't always happen. I saw how it not happen. In one case I mentioned in the book where the United States stood by us in the UN, and we repaid them by announcing, 1,000 units somewhere in the West Bank. It wasn't my happiest moment. And yes, it put us into another cycle. So I'm in no way absolving us in this book of responsibility. And that's my exhortation at the end of the book. Let's rethink how decisions are made in Israel. Not everything is domestic.
So I want to get to the heart of the book, which I think is really President Obama and your feelings about him. There's been some written about your psychoanalysis of him that you do by reading his own books. A couple of quotes from the book about Obama. Quote, I wondered about the ramifications of reconciling with a Muslim world. This was in advance of President Obama going to Cairo and making his speech. Widely opposed to Israel's existence, and whether Obama's desire to dissolve the lines of the tribe included my tribe, the Jews. In another part, you say, to an unrivaled extent, Obama identified American interests with the Palestinians. And you talk about tectonic shifts in policy under Obama. Another point, you said, the president's cold-bloodedness, while perhaps a plus in fighting terrorism, could also lead to browbeating us. So my question is, do you think that relations under President Obama are demonstrably worse than they were in previous presidencies? Because I know you know the history of fighting between U.S. and Israel. So I was confused reading the book about whether there's an exceptional nature to the tensions with Obama, or whether you really think it's worse than the past?
Okay, there's several questions in there. Let me unpack them. First of all, you made a lot of quotes, not all of them in context. Let me put it in context. Coming into this position as ambassador in 2009, at the outset of the president's first term in office, my first job is to figure out who we're working with. And the president wasn't very well known back then, not to Israelis, certainly, and I think to the United States even. I mean, he was a fantastically impressive candidate, but how deeply was he known? So my first job is to figure this out. So there's a section in the book called Obama 101. And since I wasn't a career diplomat, but an historian, I simply took my historian's skills, tools, and set them to work to figure out who he was. So I sat down with everything he wrote, every interview he gave, and particularly the books he wrote about himself, and try to create a portrait of who he was and what his worldview. I'm trying to see the world through the president's eyes. And as I say in the book, I want to get to a point where we will never be surprised. I will never be surprised. I saw this as my duty as ambassador. And you mentioned the cold-bloodedness. That's related to something that he describes in his memoirs. In his early part of his first term, every speech, he talks about his Muslim family ties. Today he doesn't, but back then he did. It's in the first inaugural address. It's in his first interview that he gave to a foreign television station, which was Al Arabiya. It was his first visits abroad, which were to Ankara and to Cairo. And it's there. He portrayed himself as a bridge. So it's a perfectly legitimate tool and question for an ambassador to ask, okay, how does this impact us? The book does say that if he can reconcile with Muslim populations of the world, this could redound to our benefit, but not if it's at our expense. And I think that's, a legitimate question to ask, an equation to pose for Israelis. He did come out quite frequently against tribes early in his term. Just recently, he was at my old synagogue in Washington and described himself as an honorary member of the tribe. But we had to think about that. What does that mean, someone who's against tribes? What does that mean? And people weren't delving into these concepts in very deep ways, but I had no choice. These are a matter of national security. Was he different than any other American president? Was he more critical of Israel than any American president? I have, the historical view. There was a famously strained relationship between David Ben-Gurion and Dwight Eisenhower. Eisenhower in 1956 threatened to sanction Israel over the Suez campaign. There was a strained relationship between Ben-Gurion and John Kennedy over the Dimona nuclear reactor. You want to look at some of these protocols, these meetings. I've read them all. Hard stuff were said. The relationship is not static. It evolved. It evolved after 67 when Lyndon Johnson woke up one morning after the Six-Day War and said, oh, there's this little superpower out there that just defeated several Soviet-backed armies. We should have a military alliance with this country. And even then, differences over settlements. Truman never accepted Israel's capital in Jerusalem. But 1981, Reagan is condemning us for the Iraqi nuclear strike. But in the mid-80s, there's a change. There's really a threshold period. Sort of mid-Reagan period, the very intimate alliance is born. And I talk about it's based on two principles, no surprises, no daylight. And that is carried on through 16-plus years of presidencies, the Clinton years and the Bush years. And we were aware that we had been sort of spoiled by this. We'd grown accustomed to this, this type of intimacy. And along comes a new man in town, President Obama, who comes into office with a different worldview, which is his prerogative as president to have a different worldview, but which includes, among other components, a collegial approach to international relations. America doesn't have to be the leader anymore. We're not the world's policeman. A heavy emphasis on international organizations like the UN that haven't always been so friendly to us. A strong emphasis on outreach to what President Obama called, even that it's a loaded term, the Muslim world. Reconciling with Iran right out of the gate. Reconciling with Iran. It's a country that wants to destroy us. And, as I said here, an unprecedented American support for the Palestinian issue in a way that we hadn't seen before. Because, remember, the first president to come out in favor of a Palestinian state was George Bush. But he had it in a sequential order. The Palestinians first had to democratize. They had to defeat terror. They had to end incitement against Israel. Then they would get the state. Obama more or less reversed the order. First to get the state, and then they democratize. For us, that was a very significant difference. You can agree with or disagree with it, but I had to deal with this. And I made policy recommendations to the prime minister on the basis of it. The book tells which policy recommendations were accepted, which weren't. But in Israel's predicament, in Israel's situation, this is our ally. This is the democratically elected head of our ally. Let's figure out what the world looks from his eyes. How can we accommodate ourselves, accord ourselves to the degree that we can? At the end of the book, I said, Israel's relationship with the United States should always be thank you, thank you. But every once in a while, we have to say thank you, but. Today, in the shadow of the nuclear negotiations in Vienna, this is a thank you, but moment. It just is. And we do it reluctantly, the but. I hope that's helpful.
Well, I mean, I think fundamentally what was puzzling to me is that you also identify a lot of times when Obama really did have Israel's back.
Yes.
Right?
I mean, why is that puzzling?
Because tachlis, I want to get a handle on what he actually did that was, say, worse than some of these other spats. Was it a tonal thing? No. Was it the comment about, I mean, that you're apoplectic about in the book, really, about the when he talks about basing a two-state solution on 67 borders with swaps?
It was very severe.
Severe? Yeah. Although, maybe we can talk a little bit about why that is so severe for the audience to understand it. You know, but I saw him, you know, with the Carmel fire, as you point out.
Moving passage, by the way, I think.
Yeah. It was when the Israeli embassy is under attack in Cairo.
Another moving passage.
Even when Israel is engaged in a war against Hamas in the Gaza Strip, and there are hundreds of civilians being killed, if I'm not mistaken, Michael, the Americans open up the stores of stored weaponry that they keep stored in Israel and resupplied Israel during the war. So
they delayed. Okay, that's it's.
But at the end of the day, they give them the weapons, even though they are the United States. President Obama is really getting hammered for supporting Israel during the Gaza war. So, for me, fundamentally, I just want to be clear. I want to be clear about what you think. If Obama really is the most hostile president in America's history, or if it was worse before. Again,
are you going to hammer that? It's not a fair question for the very simple reason that the relationship isn't static. The relationship between Israel and the United States today is not what it was in 1956. It's not what it was in 1962. It's not even what it was in 1967. But by what we had grown accustomed to over the course of a Democratic presidency and a Republican presidency, it was a departure. And the president himself talked about, I'm making a departure. He says, I'm putting daylight between Israel and the United States. He says this. We had the principle of no surprises, which existed, by the way, that was my brief coming into the embassy. We have this long-standing tradition that if the United States is going to make a major pronouncement on Middle Eastern policy that impacts Israel's security, we will have a chance to look at the text in advance and to submit comments. And this existed for, what, 16, almost 20 years. And there was a departure. The president goes to Cairo in June 2009 and makes a very long speech. It's actually twice as long as the first inaugural address. And it's full of issues that impact us, the Palestinian issue, particularly the Iran issue. The first time a president gets up and recognizes that Iran has the right to peaceful nuclear energy. But this is Iran that's seeking to destroy us. Now, those are very powerful pronouncements, but we had no forewarning of it whatsoever. You mentioned the 67 border swap issue. Let me see if, without going into too much detail, I don't want to bore you. I know, can you be bored with this stuff? We spent many days, our negotiators, working out what's called the terms of reference. That's what you conduct negotiations on with Secretary of State Clinton. And the TOR, as it's called, is emblazoned on my soul. Here it is. The United States believes that through good faith negotiations, it can reconcile the Israeli goal of a secure and independent Jewish state with defensible borders with the Palestinian goal of an independent Palestinian state based on the 1967 borders with swaps. Now, for all sorts of reasons, it was very important for Israeli negotiators, and not just during this government, but in previous governments, that the 67 borders with swaps be placed in the TOR, the Terms of Reference, as a Palestinian goal. On May 18th, 2011, I was in the White House. The next day, the president was prepared to make a major statement about the Arab Spring. And I heard rumors that there might be some part of it that would deal with us. And I went to the White House, I asked, I was told, don't worry, nothing there is going to be with you. And in the May 19th speech, the president of the United States made the 67 borders with swaps, took it from the Palestinian position and made it the United States position. I can spend an hour explaining to you why that was a big problem for us. But it really goes to the issue of trust and no surprises. And it, tell you frankly, it pertains to what's happening in the Iranian issue, because for the first time in my memory, I don't think there's much precedent for it, the United States negotiated 7 months secretly with the Iranians without telling us.
Why do you think they didn't do it?
Just keep in mind that this is an issue that just has a glancing importance for our national survival. Of course, I'm meaning that ironically. Okay. Now, that's unprecedented. That is unprecedented, and that is. And you can try to sidestep in any way and sugarcoat it, but it is a true challenge for the state of Israel. Why is it? There are many reasons, and I don't absolve Israel from some responsibility. I had a certain approach which I recommended to the prime minister. It was sometimes accepted, sometimes not accepted. But at the end of the day, it really pertains to the president's worldview. He came out immediately in 2009 and said, I'm going to do this. And we shouldn't be surprised today that he's doing it. And we shouldn't be surprised that Israel objects to it. We do. And there are structural reasons why we object to it. You may notice that the United States is a big country. It's far away from the Middle East. It's not threatened with national annihilation by the Iranians. It has the largest military capabilities of any country in the world. Israel is a tiny country. We are in Iran's backyard. The Iranian regime toward us is genocidal. And while we have a very strong army, we do not have B-2 bombers, we do not have aircraft carriers, and so our margin for error on Iran is exactly zero. Zero. Understand this. We're talking about our kids' lives here. It's not about legacy. And we also have ideological differences, conceptual differences. The president has said, and it's wonderful, it's very easy for an historian to write about President Obama because he says so often what's on his mind. He says that Iran is rational. It operates on a cost-benefit analysis. Even though it's anti-Semitic, it's rational, though it's anti-Semitic, that Iran can be a responsible regional power, that it can even help resolve the Sunni-Shiite divide. These are all quotes. I'm not making this up. Israel, we see it as an irrational regime that is trying to obliterate us, not just in word, in deed. It's the world's largest state sponsor of terror. You will read in the book how they try to assassinate me. And that'll get you to get the book now. And in Washington, D.C., by the way, in downtown Washington, there's not a rational regime from our perspective. And so it is as deep a divide as you can get over Iran. Is it worse or better than anything that came before? It is different. That we have to say, but to say that it's different and not extremely challenging would not be to reflect the reality. It's very challenging. Indeed. Okay.
I was reading a little bit of history myself, and here's a historical quiz for you. Which Please. American president said this of an Israeli prime minister? The audience can guess too if you want. Boy, that guy makes it hard for you to be his friend.
Probably George Bush Sr. or Clinton of Netanyahu.
It's Ronald Reagan, actually, talking about Begin during the whole AWACS thing when Begin was lobbying on the Hill. Right. I looked at that when I was thinking about Bibi's visit, making his speech on Iran, which I know you opposed. Mm-hmm. But there were...
Not the content of the speech, the venue of the speech.
The venue. And, yeah. Maybe those are the that was the kind of... part of the reason why the president didn't include him in some of these negotiations, which, as you point out, Israel has the most at stake in.
I don't think that was the negotiations had already been concluded by the
No, but I'm saying the kind of atmosphere, the point that Netanyahu, who knows America, went and gave that speech anyway. It got into, that was the culmination already of so much tension between them.
You're so right. You're right. I can't disagree with you. The book tells the story of how we got to that point. And what you may ask, what does all this have to do with the Iranian issue? The issue of trust is so, so basic here. And because trust is a matter truly of national survival for us, I'll just give you a small example that's happened in the last few weeks. The administration's messaging, as it's called, its mantras, beginning in 2009, was the United States has Israel's back, right? All options are on the table, and I'm not bluffing. And just about 2 weeks ago, the president gave an interview on Israeli television where he said there never really was a military option. So what does that mean? He was bluffing? But that goes to the essence of trust, which is not an academic question for us. And the book traces the crises of trust and the successive crises of trust that amount to the situation where you described, where the United States conducts negotiations without telling us on issues that are vital for our national security. But it's a long story.
So you don't believe that President Obama and his team are actually trying to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon? Or do you think that they're trying and they're just failing miserably with their approach? Because they're too
naive. We do not believe that this deal, and by the way, I'm talking about, I'm in Knesset now, we agree about nothing, we scream at each other. If the seats weren't screwed down, we'd throw it at one another. The perception that this deal is exceedingly bad for the state of Israel is multi-partisan. I can point at just almost nobody within that 120-member body who thinks otherwise. Now, that's saying something. And here, so many former members of the president's own team have come out and say it's a bad deal. And five former advisors came out just literally this week and said it's a bad deal. Robert Gates has said it's a bad deal. And people are quite knowledgeable. Alan Cooperman, probably the America's most knowledgeable person about nuclear physics. And these issues came out with the New York Times op-ed last week that said that this will give them a breakout period of a month, you know, at the most. These are serious people, not just us. The difference is between the American advisors and, you know, Alan Cooperman is that, you know, our lives are at stake here. Ultimately, I think it's America. This deal is bad, not just for Israel. It's bad for America and the world. But that's our duty to say that. And
you agree that publicly, the way it's been said, it's constructive or not, or has it helped in some way? Maybe. I mean, Bibi did give a very powerful speech on the Hill. I mean, so maybe it resonated with Congress, who you say in your book is Israel's ally. I mean, you go to Congress every time there's a problem with the executive branch. Mm. So maybe it wasn't all
negative. Or I can give the flip side. Again, I don't want to give away all the great, you know, the exciting parts of this book. But the book also traces the way we cooperated with the president's policy on Iran. I'll give you just one example. In the late fall, early winter of 2009, the United States reached, preferred to Iran, a compromise formula known as the TRR formula. Don't you love this? TOR, TR. There's going to be a quiz afterward on all this. TRR stood for Tehran Research Reactor. And the plan was to take the nuclear stockpile, the enriched uranium, that Iran had then, by the way, which didn't include 20%, it was only 3.5%, and ship it out to France and to Russia to have it processed to 20% and then sent back to a Tehran research reactor where it would be made into medical isotopes. Now, this was a risk for us. You know, Iran needs no nuclear isotopes. I don't know, they could buy them. It was a huge risk for us, and it was a bitter debate within Israel. Ehud Barak, the labor defense minister, opposed it, but Netanyahu accepted it. He went out on a limb. The Iranians rejected it, by the way. The Iranians rejected it. But I trace in the book the times when we went quite far out. The biggest example was the fall of 2012, days before the U.S. election, and there's a tremendous sense that Israel's going to act preemptively against Iran. This is where the gray hair comes in, folks. This was the toughest period, and it gets caught up in the election. And is Bibi going to order a strike against Iran and get the and somehow create the problem for the Democratic Party? And is he doing, is he going to strike Iran to get the Mitt Romney to be elected president? All this is going on. And in the middle of it, what does Netanyahu do? He takes a drawing of a bomb with a fuse. I was there when he drew it. And he goes up on the General Assembly and he says, here's the red line. If they pass the red line, that's where we're in trouble. The red line was 90% enriched uranium. And I was in the room 10 minutes later when the president called him and thanked him ardently for giving him, the president, time and space to work out a nuclear arrangement. Now, that's called building trust. That was based on trust. Who violated the trust? He paid an immense price for that. Now, again, the situation is going to be very nuanced here. Everyone's going to try to make it black and white. Nothing's black and white in diplomacy, nor in human affairs. But that's a story. And you can't understand where we are today, Janine, without going through that experience. And that was traumatic.
I want to talk about the Jewish journalist part in the book, and I want to talk about Gaza, and then I'm going to move to some of the questions. I just want to read this one paragraph where you talk, I mean, you refer repeated throughout to a few different journalists, but one point that you make is, the pinch I felt reading articles censorious of Israel sharpened into a stab whenever the names on the bylines were Jewish. Almost all of the world's countries are nation states. So what, I wonder, drove these writers to nitpick at theirs? Some, I knew, saw assailing Israel as a career enhancer, the equivalent of Jewish man bites dog that saved several struggling pundits from obscurity. Others seemed to disdain Israel the way upper-class American Jews of German ancestry once scorned the poor Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe, the Yiddish-speaking rabble who allegedly made all Jews look bad. Others, still largely assimilated, resented Israel for further complicating their already conflicted identity. Can you explain what drove you to write that paragraph? And if truly believe this?
Yeah. I know I truly believe it. I'll stand by it. Listen, again, it's taken out of context. This was the hardest part of the book. There's a part of the book called We Are One with a question mark, because in my generation, I'm old, a bit older than you. We grew up under the logo of UJA, which was We Are One. And the book, 400 pages, took me a year to write. I took off 50 days for the Gaza war last summer to defend Israel. Those 4 pages took me an entire month. And I went back to them again and again and agonized over those 4 pages, our relationship with American Jewry. And there's also a section about our relationship with the press, but there's a bit of an overlap here. And here was the fact, and I think this is an irrefutable fact, and that is, if you look at the people who write in media today in the United States, there is a disproportionate number of Jews. Jews are very, very active in the American media. And I, in the previous paragraph, I talk about how anti-Semites are always saying how the Jews control the media, and that's why the media is pro-Israel. Well, the first part may be right. Jews are very active in the media, and I talk about all the Jews on the op-ed pages. The op-ed pages I liken to a loud mishpucha argument between various people on the right and left. Look at the people who have the columns. But the fact that Jews are very, very highly represented in the media does not mean that the American media is pro-Israel. And I had, again, this is a book that's going to touch on every tough issue. I'm not shying away from everything, but it's true. As a Jew, as an Israeli, every time there were these very critical articles of Israel written by an American Jew, it hurt more than it was a non-Jew. It just does. I'm just being honest here. And it is true that there are American Jewish journalists, and I'm not going to start naming names here, who make a point of saying, I'm Jewish, therefore I can criticize Israel. I'm not those guys. I'm not those settlers. I'm not those Likudniks. I'm different. And again, I think that's an unassailable observation. It's there. And it's something I had to deal with. It's just something I had to deal with as an ambassador, something I had to deal with as a Jew. And it was painful. I'm talking about pain here. You see it as criticism. I see it as pain. And I give specific examples of just some horrific things that were written by Jews in largely Jewish edited journals. One of them, you know, this whole accusation that Israelis are the world's leader in human organ trade. Front page issues. And also where these articles appeared. They're on the back page and the front page. Over the fold. And it's painful. I think it's at some point a great challenge for us, even to our security, but it's painful. And I have to ask myself, okay, what is it? What is leading these people? And you, with this, what you're reading here is an internal, I'm bringing my reader into my internal dialogue with myself. Why? Why is this happening? Is it because we make them uncomfortable? I mean, there are lots of countries in the world. Like I said, there are 194 states in the world. Most of them are nation states. 189 of them are nation states. What is it about the Jewish nation state that so upsets them? Later in the book, I talk about a correspondence that I have with my former college roommate, who's a very prominent Washingtonian and is very critical of Israel at times. And I asked him, all right, what bothers you more? When Israel accidentally kills a Palestinian child, Israeli forces have accidentally killed a Palestinian child in the West Bank, or when American forces bomb an Afghani wedding and kill 24 people, what bothers you more? And if the former bothers you more, you've got to ask yourself why. You've got to. That's just being intellectually and spiritually honest. And I challenge a lot of people to answer that question differently. I care much more about the 24 Afghanis that our forces, the American forces, killed by accident than the Palestinian child that Israeli forces might kill. And my guess is, for a certain type of American Jews, that is more painful, is more problematic. That chapter, just I'll stop with this because we can go on forever on this. The chapter opens, I never read from my own book, but here, the chapter on We Are One opens with me going to an art exhibit. Strange enough, it was one that was donated to me in my name at an American university, and this 90-year-old woman comes up to me, and she says to me the following: I like you, but I don't like what your country does. And I said to her, Madam, do you like everything your country does? And she says to me, quote unquote, No, but your country must be perfect. And that starts this whole discussion about Israel and American Jewry. Do I sound emotional? It's emotional.
Well, I felt very emotional too reading it. Because You know, when I spent 2 decades reporting on Israel and the Middle East, and when I would travel, my name is Janine Zacharia, and people would always say to me, "Where are you from? Where are you from?" And I'd say, "Oh, I'm from New York. I'm from New York," you know. And they'd be, "No, where are you from?" They want to know, are you Jewish? Are you Arab? And to me, it was not a relevant question.
This is in the Middle East, or
in the
Israel?
Middle East. Israel, sure. Too. They said, what is this name, Janine?
Janine Zacharia, you know, could be an Arab Christian
Maze,
name.
What is this? They made fun of my name, you know. Mm. Do you know where this is? You know, and the Palestinians welcome, you know. But I felt that, you know, I don't have a conflicted identity. I don't think Ethan Bronner had a conflicted identity. Isabel Kirshen doesn't have a conflicted identity. I don't think Thomas Friedman has a conflicted identity. And I think that a lot of what upsets me is that what you've said in the book, basically, is that you cannot be a writer on Israel and be critical of Israeli or Netanyahu's policies without being deemed anti-Israel or in some ways a conflicted identity Jew.
Can you quote me on that? Because that is far from what I've said. What I've said is the following, and I say this openly in the book. Yeah, you know, American Jews who are Jewish and writing about Israel, you know, that's their job. It's fine. I point out the American Jewish writers who are going out of their way to single out Israel. And what I used to call, I used to use the name of a certain columnist in Washington who only wrote about domestic issues, only, except Israel. And then Israel only critically. Now, what is that? What is that phenomenon? Now, maybe you'd like me to ignore it, Janine, but I can't.
One example, Ruth Marcus. I mean, I think, you know, take a walk in the inbox of any correspondent on the Middle East who's written about Israel, and you get hammered from both sides. And what's dangerous about this, from my perspective, is by highlighting the Jewish ancestry of the writers, you're saying it's just not, it's like a kind of weird anti-Semitism.
But it's not. You're attributing something I'm not saying. I'm talking about, now that you've mentioned Ruth Marcus, what we used to call it the embassy, the Ruth Marcus syndrome. I'm Jewish, therefore, yes, I usually write about American domestic issues, except for Israel. And in ways that are very challenging to us. And that's not anti-Semitic, it's just recognizing a fact. And, you know, Ethan Bronner, a good friend, but when Ethan Bronner's son went into the Israeli army, people in the New York Times wanted to fire him, wanted to take him away his job. You know, it's not me saying that. I have no problem with Ethan Bronner's son going in the army. I thought it was rather cool. It was the New York Times that had a problem with it. Whether he could be objective in reporting about Israel if his son's in the Israeli army. And you remember this debate. So don't kindly impute to me things I don't say in my book, but which I think I'm pointing out an unassailable reality. It exists. I know it's controversial. I know it's painful. There's a lot of pain in this book. But to take that and leap that into, I'm accusing these people of anti-Semitism?
No, but I'm saying there are a lot of people who say that Jews shouldn't be able to report on Israel because they can't be objective. And by highlighting it and saying that they, you know, the Judaism of it, I'm worried that it plays into actually other people's hands.
So you're having a Jewish problem with this. You're having a Jewish problem.
I never think of myself as a Jewish American journalist.
But that's
I don't think that Thomas Friedman thinks. I think they think of them as
Thomas
analysts.
Friedman often talks about, I'm a Jew, therefore I can say this. I mean, it's part of his Weltanschauung, his worldview, and it is. And when Tom and I talk about my relationship here, when he writes a line that, you know, Netanyahu must know that when he gets the ovation in Congress, that is paid for by the Israel lobby. The ovation is paid for the lobby. That is a real problem. You want to talk about anti-Semitism? That is touching on one of the oldest anti-Semitic tropes there is, and that is that Jews buy influence. That's what it is. And the book tells about how I got on the phone and begged him to take it back, and he wouldn't. And to me, that's an issue. You can skirt it. You know, you can write a fluffy book that's not going to touch on these issues. But I wasn't going to do it. I made a decision that I wasn't going to run away from any of these tough issues. And I did.
Well, it's an interesting section for people to read when they pick up the book, and they can make their own decision on that. Let's broaden it to the American Jewish community, which I know this is something that a lot of people are asking about in the cards.
Yeah.
What should be the role of the American Jewish community when it comes to Israel?
I think American Jews, if you're asking whether they have a right to criticize, they have a right to criticize. And I spent much of my time going through synagogues in the United States, giving several speeches, one of which was called Israel and American Jewry, What Can We Expect of One Another? Hard question. What can we expect of one another? And on the Israeli side, Israel claims to be the nation state of the Jewish people, and I think it's about time we start living up to that claim. And not investigating whether how different people practice or don't practice their Judaism. We are the nation state of the Jewish people, or we aren't. And that raises all sorts of very difficult issues, difficult politically, by the way, for me. Israel, when it makes a policy decision, should take into consideration the way those policies impact the American Jewish community, because the American Jewish community is our hinterland. We don't have a hinterland. I don't know if everyone's Jewish here, but the American Jewish community is our hinterland. Let's not alienate our hinterland. Be a good idea, strategically. So I keep on going back in the book, I talk about issues like women of the wall and conversion issues, trying to convince Israelis who don't understand these reforming conservative women that they want to wear, you know, tefillin and pray for Torahs. They don't get it. But I had to explain it to them in their terms. It's strategic. It's not a PR issue. It's not even a Jewish issue. It's a strategic issue. You want a relationship with the United States, you may not want to, you know, arrest these women. I spent more time on the women of war. There's a whole chapter on women of the wall as a strategic issue. But what can we Israelis expect of American Jewry? What you can expect is that, first of all, respect our democratic system. You may not like the outcome of our elections, okay, but Israel's democracy is truly one of our greatest accomplishments. Again, I mentioned we're part of that small club of that tiny group of countries that have never known a second of non-democratic governance, but we are the only member of that club that's also never known a second of peace. And the fact that Israel is democratic is nothing short of miraculous, and that we have elections. And, you know, especially the last 15 years with the rockets and the suicide bombers and everything we go through, it has a political impact. Understand us. At least you don't have to agree with everything we say, but at least respect our decision. One of the big problems I had in the book, and also with the Obama administration, was people saying, we understand Israel's interests better than Israelis do. That's extraordinary. They came to us during the Arab Spring when the Egyptians elected Morsi, and they said, well, democracy you have to express. You have to respect the outcome of a democratic election. Well, how about respecting ours? And that, I think, you can understand. And I expect American Jews to understand our geostrategic dilemma, which is that we live in a terrible neighborhood that is unraveling in our hands. That, yes, we can support a two-state solution, and I support a two-state solution, even though I don't think we have a partner, and even if that other state was created, what's it going to look like? It's a Palestinian state that has no democratic, has no institutions, no economy, and has an unelected, corrupt leadership. I don't know if you know this, but last summer, Hamas tried to kill Mahmoud Abbas. Guess who saved him? We did. You want to pull out? You want him dead? You want the IDF to pull out? We're dealing with it. This is not an academic debate for us. This is reality. We can't have 100,000 rockets in the West Bank. Understand our history, what we've gone through when we withdrew from Gaza in 2005, drew from Lebanon in 2000, and got thousands of rockets fired at us. Understand that. That's all. You can still support a two-state solution. It's fine. You can criticize the settlements. It's fine. But just understand it. That's what we can expect of one another. And it was the most heartfelt speech I could possibly give. I do believe we are one people. I do. That's the answer to that question. We are a rambunctious, creative, loud, sometimes impossible people. P.S., if anybody has any doubt that we are directly descended from the people of the Bible, just look at what Moses had to put up with. We're exactly those people. When Moses looking at God saying, what did you do to me with these people? We're exactly the same. Knesset is like, and I desperately love the Jewish people. I talk about it, Freud would call it an oceanic love of the Jewish people. Just do. I want to preserve them. I want us to have that common dialogue, that conversation. Even though we occupy such different realities. Israel is a normal country, more or less, in a profoundly abnormal environment situation. I want to get to the questions, but I'm in Knesset, and I had this discussion. I'm one of the representatives on the Constitutional Committee, and we had a discussion about whether the State of Israel should give advantages to light industries in the settlements around the Gaza area. These guys have been shelled and mortared for years, and it should be an open and shut case. Of course we should give advantages to those people, but all of a sudden, various NGOs come in. Israel has a very deep civil society, and says, wait a minute. How do you define the Gaza area? It turns out it's seven kilometers from the Gaza border. What about someone who has a factory 7 kilometers and 3 meters from the Gaza border? Does he get the same advantages? What about the people up north? What about Kiryat Shmona? They've been also south. Should we give the same advantages to Kiryat Shmona? And if we give the same advantages to Kiryat Shmona in the Gaza area, does the factory close in a lot? And what about the guy who has a factory in the Gaza area, but he lives in Tel Aviv? All right. And this debate is going on, and I'm sitting there with my mouth hanging open. Because this is a perfectly rational debate about a completely insane situation, about a population being shelled by thousands of rockets. Think about this. This is our reality. And that we've been able to remain that normal, that we can even have this discussion, please appreciate that. Just appreciate it. You don't have to agree with it. Just appreciate it. We should all, Israelis, Jews, and American Jews, pause, stop, and think for a second, just how incredibly fortunate we are to be alive at this moment in Jewish history, where there are these two vibrant, large, successful Jewish communities in the world. Every Jew in the world today is free, which was completely not the case when we were kids. Think about that. And for just a minute, be very, very grateful. Cool. Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of questions about American Jewry here, naturally, and your love for American Jewry, you made clear, but this questioner asks, I'm tired of Israelis judging American Jews as ersatz Jews. We aren't Jewish enough because we aren't real Zionists, because we live here. We haven't served in the IDF, no skin in the game, and we don't have the right to criticize Israel or its policies. We are good enough for your money, but nothing else, and yet when we try to tell Israel to buzz off, we are also told we're to blame. It's a bad deal.
I'm not going to take issue with it. It's an issue I deal with the book. I actually, you know, acknowledging this reality that in the book I say something very radical. I said, we've grown, in Israel, we've grown accustomed to getting the support, often unconditional, of American Jews, particularly Jews whose form of Judaism we as a state don't recognize. And I don't think we can take that for granted. I don't think we should take it for granted. I think we have to work proactively to claim it, to change it. Yes, I think criticism of Israel is justified at times, but keeping in mind our reality. We criticize policies. I don't know what exactly about that part you want me to take issue with.
No, I'm just,
about the
you
question.
Know, I guess it's just I wanted that person's frustration to be able to be aired in the context of the conversation we're having. What does that mean, keeping in mind our reality? What happens if you're sitting here in this audience and you watched with fear the war last summer? Because you do care about Israel, and you care deeply, and you don't want them being shelled, but you're worried that this tactic, which has been tried before, to bomb Gaza, and is not going to achieve the objective, that they're still going to have their arsenal, that they're still going to have their tunnels. And even if you didn't care about the death toll on the Palestinian side, the Israelis sent the mighty IDF into, they became like a demolition crew to try and deal with these tunnels, and 66 Israeli reservists are killed in what was criticized as, described as really a non-planned war. Are you allowed, as an American Jew sitting in San Francisco, to express distress over this and criticism of that policy?
What's allowed mean? I mean,
we're not
the speech police in the state of Israel. You can say whatever you want in the Bay Area. Some of the things you say, I may say, wait a minute, we have a reality, as not to belabor the term, which is more complex. And I understand your discomfort, because every night we're being bombarded by bombs, by rockets. You're being bombarded by terrible images in your media, which is not easy either. I don't in any way to belittle that. It's very difficult. I don't know where the question is going. Do they have a right to criticize Israeli policies as we conducted the war last summer? Of course, everyone has the right. The question is, I'm asking what I can expect. What I can expect of American Jews, if you're going to criticize us, understand our reality and how complex it is. Think about how hard it is to be an Israeli leader in that situation, where you have members of your own government saying, you've got to go in and conquer Gaza. If you remember, the foreign minister at the time, Avigdor Lieberman, called a press conference, we've got to go in and conquer these guys. And you know, as a leader of Israel, what does that mean, conquering Gaza? And there was growing pressure on the government, by the way, for this. There still is. It means going in and fighting house to house and killing thousands of Palestinians and certainly a great number of Israeli casualties as well, incurring the wrath of the world, being branded as war criminals. That's the choice. What's the alternative? You create a situation where you can have another Gaza war tomorrow. How would you like to make that decision? How hard is that? That's called sovereignty. And just all I ask is just appreciation, just how difficult that call is. how difficult it is to fight an enemy who is dug in behind its own population, using them as human shields, trying not just to kill Israeli civilians, but try to get Israeli soldiers to kill Palestinian civilians, because that is actually their goal, because their goal is not, you know, they have a military tactic, but they have a diplomatic and media strategy, which is to delegitimize us. They want to get to a point where they can fire rockets at us, but we can't fight back because we have no legitimacy. That's what this is all about, by the way. And complex reality, but certainly you can say whatever you want. no one's going to come knocking on your door. This is not Tehran here.
Two political questions with a presidential election approaching. Would you prefer Jewish voters in the U.S. voting Republican?
I prefer Jewish voters in the United States to vote.
Another question. Jews in America overwhelmingly supported President Obama in the elections. Do you think they made the best choice based on the current state of affairs in the Middle East?
Well, I don't think most American Jews base their choices on what the state of care of the Middle East. I know from my own family. I have a very big family. I made Aliyah completely alone. I have almost no family in Israel, no close family. My family's here. Part of it in California. And I don't know of anybody in my family who voted Republican in 2012. And they care about Israel. They love me. I'm a nice guy. They have Israeli relatives. I asked them, okay, what were your choices based on? It's overwhelming. This is very interesting. What do you think their choice was based on? The composition of the Supreme Court. Yeah, everyone's going, yeah. And you've seen it in action this week, by the way. Saw it in action. So does that mean it's not a zero-sum game? They care passionately about Israel, but they also care passionately about the composition of the Supreme Court. And ultimately, that was determined their vote. And that's my family, whom I love and respect.
Yeah. Sticking with politics, how will Hillary Clinton be? Better for Israel if elected president?
I think that the book paints a portrait of Hillary Clinton, which is, I think, on balance, very favorable.
It was, actually. It was pretty positive, I thought.
Yeah, because I greatly enjoyed working with her. She's a formidable individual, powerful intellect, indefatigable. I don't know how she did it. But I want to say this. I'm not going to get involved in internal American politics here and say vote for this person or that person, but the issue is not so much Hillary Clinton as it is the Democratic Party, which is moving in a certain direction. We have to take stock of it and understand that if a Democrat is elected in 2016, Israel cannot expect to maintain the status quo in its policies toward the West Bank and Palestinian issues and expect not to have issues. I understand that. Was that a amen? Amen. So just understand it. I'm all about reality checks, folks. I'm all about reality checks, and we have to, again, it's the ambassadorial's job, and it's also the member of Knesset's job. I think it's also the Jewish job to face up to reality. This is reality, and just that everyone should know.
So flesh that out, Michael. What does your two-state solution look like, and how are we going to get there?
My two-state solution is as I described it in this Wall Street Journal article several months ago called The Two-State Situation, was that we cannot reach a two-state solution right now, and even if we did, it would be extremely problematic. I talk about the Oslo process, and I was involved in this process from its beginnings almost, is predicated, first of all, on a Western model of people sitting opposite sides of a table and signing a piece of paper, which is not usually the Middle Eastern model, which is people sort of wink and nod, let's not put this down on paper. Like right now, Israel exports all of Palestinians' agricultural produce from the West Bank because Syria is closed off. All of our trucks operate. We keep the West Bank Palestinian, we keep the Palestinian Authority alive this way too, not just security-wise, but economically. Now, none of this is written down. You guys don't even know about this, do you? But that's the idea. We don't want you to know about it because it works. It's actually a type of coexistence that works. So I want to take that model, which is a Middle Eastern model, of working in cooperation with Palestinians and perhaps others in the Middle East, but not to formalize it. And to ask the question, do not ask what each side cannot give. Let us ask what each side can give, given the current situation. I know this is a radical notion, because the Oslo process is predicated on a number of things which neither side can give for the foreseeable future. For example, it's asking the Palestinians to recognize us as a Jewish state, which is very, very difficult for them. It goes to the heart of their identity. But that's the only way to really end the conflict, on basis of mutual recognition of the unassailable right to self-determination. That's how you end the conflict. Very difficult for them. So let's not ask them to do that. They don't have to recognize us. I don't want them to. They don't have to say end of claims, end of conflict. They don't have to give up their claim to Jaffa and Haifa. We can create a situation where 90% of the Palestinians in the West Bank right now really never encounter Israelis. They don't encounter Israeli soldiers. Let's take that reality and make it stronger. Let's give them more freedom. Let's give them better transportation. Let's give them more water and create 40,000 jobs in the agricultural sector. Let's encourage our friends in the world, like the Europeans, to build institutions there. This is what my friend Salam Fayyad was doing when he was the prime minister before Mahmoud Abbas kicked him out. He was building institutions. And let's work to lay the basis for a two-state solution, but before we get there, let's have a two-state situation where we get out of their hair, they get out of their hair, and this whole idea of divorcing the Palestinians, which you know you used to hear during the Oslo, I'm against that. I don't want to divorce them. I want to live together. We don't have to be married. We can be roommates. We can share a building. But
are you talking about a West Bank first solution, sort of like Shaul Mufaz talk? We can't deal with it. Let's set aside Gaza, Hamas. Let's do a deal with Abbas in the West Bank.
Do we have an alternative?
Well, that's what I just want to be clear. That's what you're actually talking about.
Yeah, I'm talking about what used to be called by again, we're getting into the diplomatic jargon. We used to call stage tours. And this is nothing carcinogenic about it. This is stage tours was diplomacy. It referred to the second stage of the roadmap, 2002, Bush's roadmap. And stage two talked about interim solutions. So you couldn't reach a final agreement. Let's have interim solutions that redound to the benefit of both sides. Shaul Mufaz, the former chief of staff and foreign minister, agreed with that. So did Ehud Barak. And I was with them. I agreed with them. I think if we cannot reach the two-state solution, but that should remain our policy, by the way. And we should always say we're at the table, even if the chair opposite us is empty. We're always at the table. But until that time, we're going to lay the groundwork by ourselves if we have to. I think they're actually Palestinian partners for this. We will lay the groundwork for a future two-state solution. We just did something good. In the campaign, I ruffled a bunch of feathers by saying that Israel should link the Palestinian town of Rawabi to water. Now, you know this whole thing? You probably remember. Rawabi is this great Palestinian initiative to create a neighborhood outside of Ramallah, which is the envy of every Israeli, because it's a great apartments for $100,000, which is totally unthinkable in Israel. It's ecologically sound. It's a beautiful neighborhood. A lot of Palestinians, especially in the PA, hated Rawabi because it belies the Palestinian narrative of suffering and oppression. This was the good life in Palestine. And there was a wonderful contractor who managed to overcome all these obstacles, and the only problem was that Rawabi wasn't occupied. It was a ghost city. Why? Because we wouldn't hook it up to our water grid. Because the pipe would pass through Area C, which under the Oslo Accords in 1993 was supposed to be only controlled by Israel. And I went out in the campaign trail and I said, this is nuts. Israel not only has an interest in hooking Rawabi up to its water, we have an interest in 40 Rawabis being cut. This is the basis of Palestinian normal life, and we can interact with these people and build industrial parks with these people. And finally, this is only about a month or two ago, the defense minister, Ya'alon, hooked it up. And now Rawabi is being, people are buying apartments and moving in. And I think that is precisely, Rawabi in a way encapsulates the way we should proceed. Let's do what's good for us.
Can it only be for West Bank Palestinians, or is there a way to relax, say, the economic boycott on Palestinians in Gaza as well?
It's a hard question. It's a legitimate question. Because I think last summer, the Hamas tried mightily to ignite a third intifada on the West Bank, and it failed. It failed because the Palestinians in the West Bank had what to lose. So you can conclude that Israel has an interest in creating a situation where the West Bank Palestinians have something to lose. By contrast, the Palestinians in Gaza have nothing to lose. And you see what happens. So we have an interest in creating a situation where the people in Gaza have something to lose. The only problem is we have to ask the question, in giving them what to lose, are we giving giving Hamas what to gain? And then you get into the question of concrete. My first meeting at the White House was in May 2009, and the issue was concrete for Gaza. This was in the aftermath of the Cast-Lead operation. And the administration put on a pretty hard court press on us to let concrete into the Gaza Strip. You saw what happened to the concrete. And last summer, Dennis Ross came out with an op-ed in the Washington Post saying, and he recalled this meeting, and he said, we made a mistake. We goofed. It's a very expensive mistake. So yes, the answer to your question is yes, but how do we do this without strengthening Hamas?
So we've only got about 5 minutes left, and there's a couple questions about Netanyahu and two-state and one 10-year-old. Why do you think the Israeli prime minister is against a two-state solution? And maybe to wrap up, Michael, you can talk, given the time you've spent with the prime minister. I learned some interesting things about him, that he enjoys Breaking Bad. That's the only time he actually relaxes, you say in the book, if I'm paraphrasing that correctly. But he's made a lot of American Jews, on the left at least, uncomfortable as prime minister, I would say. And the way it played out during the election, the way he spoke about Israeli Arabs, the way he spoke about a two-state solution, I think confused people. So is it your analysis of Netanyahu that he is a pure politician, a superior? You praise him for his political skills and his ability to navigate that hornet's nest in Israel politically, but... or is it more the Bibi Netanyahu who really messianically feels the need that he needs to protect the Jewish people, and he does not believe that a deal with the Palestinians will last?
Yeah, I don't know why protecting the Jewish people is messianic. I think it's actually his job description. But he probably doesn't get paid enough for it. But I wrote this, I told you about Obama 101 section of the book. There's also a portrait of Netanyahu. Now, I got appointed to this job. I didn't know him that well. I was never a member of the Likud. I wasn't part of his close circle. He appointed me because I knew America well, and he saw that perhaps I could help bridge some of the gaps with this new administration, which was, as I said, a very different administration with a different worldview. And over the course of the years, I got to know him fairly well. I don't say I know him intimately, but fairly well. And the portrait of Netanyahu appears relatively late in the book, because at the point in which I felt I got to know him. And also a very difficult time to write a portrait of a prime minister who's still in office, and to say things about him which are, you know, not so easy, was another challenge. Probably the second most difficult part of the book was the portrait of Netanyahu. Used some of the same methodology that I used with Obama. I talked about his relationship with his father, his relationship with his brother, his relationship with his wife. This is all, you know, dicey turf. But how do you begin to understand this man? One of the things I said was that his father, Ben Sion, was an historian, and that he imparted to his son a very, what's known as the lachrymose interpretation of Jewish history, that Jewish history is a long series of inquisitions and expulsions and massacres culminating in the greatest mass murder in human history. And it's a very dark world. And I talk about my conversations with Netanyahu were always punctuated with references to Jewish disasters. It's a very dark view. And this, of course, impacts his policy. But far more than that, Netanyahu sees himself as a man in history. What does that mean? We're all in history in some way. Some of us, you know, I guess we're all going to be history. But alas, mortality. He sees himself in a transformational role, and he sees himself as having been entrusted by history with a destiny. And that destiny, as you alluded to, is to save the Jewish people from existential threats, Iran, for example. And whenever newly appointed American officials, administration officials, would come to me and say, okay, who is Benjamin Netanyahu, I would always start out, understand that he sees himself as a man in history, that he's about destiny. And once you understand that's the key. Now, is he fulfilling that role? Is he succeeding that role? I mean, history will determine that, whether he has or not. That's, by the way, I'm letting off the last paragraph of the book. But, and you're right. The book also describes the sort of zigzag on the two-state solution during the election. The remark about Israeli Arabs, all of that, by the way, I was the author of our party's reaction to that, which was, I'm proud to say, was the first reaction, and it was quite strong. And Netanyahu apologized for that remark. He reiterated his support for the two-state solution, is doing it now in the face of a lot of opposition in his party and in the coalition. It is our party's position, so it's easy for me to say, you know, that's great, but other people take issue with it. And he is Israel's longest-serving prime minister, short of Ben-Gurion. He's closing in on his goal. So he's going to be an interesting subject for historians in subsequent decades. He'll always be looked back. They're going to try to understand this person. As an historian, I was always appreciative of ambassadors who wrote their memoirs, because you think that historians only use documents in archives, but documents in archives is just one person's opinion at one time, and believe me, it's very subjective, and diplomats are always writing things with a view that 30 years from now, someone's going to be reading this thing. So what they thought in real time was always very interesting for me, and I thought I would contribute my little humble contribution to history through this, and I allude to this at the end. I hope that we will look back at this period 40, 50, 60 years from now. Maybe we'll scratch our heads a little bit. Maybe we'll stare and wonder. Maybe we'll ask hard questions. Why didn't we get it right? We'll ask many questions. All of us, I personally am humbled by history. The issues that we see as monumental over the course of decades become smaller and smaller, and our roles in them become footnotes. I'm aware of that. I'm aware that I do that with humbly. And yet, as human actors in dramas, and we have been in a drama for the last few years, we're in a drama today with these negotiations in Vienna, what choice do we have? We have to fulfill the roles that either Jewish history or destiny gave to us. We do them the best we can. Sometimes we succeed, sometimes we don't. That is our role. That is our role, and it's also our responsibility.
With that, let's thank Michael for joining us tonight. He'll be signing books out in the lobby.
We're threatened now with boycotts and sanctions, particularly from Europe. And I'm strongly of the opinion that Israel should work to make it difficult for them. As I'm in politics now, and I was had the privilege of designing my party's diplomatic platform. It was a big incentive for me to join this party. And I'm strongly in favor of limiting where Israel builds in Judea, Samaria, the West Bank, to only those areas that will be part of a Jewish state in any future two-state solution. Even if it doesn't look like we're going to get that two-state solution. Well, it's okay. You can clap. It's fine. I'll pause. It's not an easy policy to adopt, but it is formally my policy. I wrote an article a couple months ago in the Wall Street Journal called The Two-State Situation, which says, what do we do if we don't have a two-state solution right now? How should Israel act? To preserve ourselves as a democratic and Jewish Israel, on one hand, but also defend ourselves against boycotts and sanctions. And I think sometimes we make it easier. We're dealing with BDS all the time. And boycott, divestment, sanctions, I'm sure you've heard of it. It's an international movement. It's very well funded and directed. And it is not about Israel, the situation after 67. It's about Israel, the situation after 1948. It's not designed to get a better two-state solution. It's designed to take us down. But
and
BDS will
sure
use...
I don't know if everybody would say that, Michael. It's designed to take you down?
Yes.
You don't think nobody in the BDS movement that sees it differently? It's designed to take it down? We mean like destroy the state?
She's making a valid point. Hold up. Let me defend Janine. Okay? Let me defend Janine. You're making a very valid point. Not everybody involved in BDS is trying to take down Israel. That's what I'm trying to get to. BDS will often pose as an organization that's anti-settlement. I can point to websites and say, you're against settlements, you want a Palestinian state, join us. But if you look at who's funding it, who's doing this, these are people who are not about two-state solution. They're about a one-state solution, which includes Israel's dissolution. That's what BDS is. And to understand that, I'm against making it hard on BDS. Let's not give them a tool to use against us. Let's make it tough for them. And so that's where I'm taking it. I think there are many people who cooperate with BDS not knowing what BDS really is.
So examples of that, what you were saying, were limiting construction to blocks of territory that, as you frequently say everyone understands will remain part of a two-state solution. Part of a is that what
not
the
everyone
idea?
Understands, and, but right, there's right, a wide understanding.
What that means,
that
everyone.
Way.
I don't know, but everyone.
Well, Europe
maybe.
Doesn't understand. Europe does not accept the formula that was set out by George Bush and Eric Sharon in 2004, the Bush-Sharon letter, and which I want to revive. And which said that the settlement blocks, 85% of the settlers are in these blocks. The blocks are about 2% of the West Bank and the Jewish neighborhoods of Jerusalem. And if you look at the Pally Weeks, this is the stuff that leaked out about the negotiations between Ehud Olmert and Mahmoud Abbas in 2007 and 8, you see that the Palestinians were willing to give up these areas. And what I stress in the book was that by not standing by the Bush-Sharon letter, and by the way, here, we more or less, strange bedfellows. The Obama administration, when it came into office, disavowed the letter, but Israel didn't stick by it. So what we did is, essentially, without getting into too much detail, we erased the difference between building, say, a balcony in Gilo, in Jerusalem, and building a settlement in far-flung Samaria, Itamar. We erased that difference. But that not only hurt Israel, it also hurt the Palestinians. What did it do? Bush-Sharon created space. And in diplomacy, I've learned you need space. So the Israeli government may feel compelled to build something. Maybe there's a terrorist attack. You have public opinion. But you don't want to build in Samaria. Maybe you want to build in Maale Adumim, if you know where this is, outside of Jerusalem. And that, you know, lets off steam. And if the Palestinians can say, okay, they're building in Maale Adumim, but we're going to continue negotiating, that's good. But what was created is a situation starting in 2009 where the Palestinians could not be less Palestinian than the President of the United States. And if the President of the United States was not distinguishing between building in Gilo and building in Itamar, then Mahmoud Abbas couldn't do it. And he said it. He gave it an interview to your old paper, to the Washington Post, where he said that the president basically put me up a tree,
right,
and then he kicked away the ladder. That's who he's referring to. It's just what he was referring to. So it took away space, and just tactically, if you want to get ahead on peace, it wasn't a good movement. Hillary Clinton now has written about it in her memoirs as well and said it was not a good idea. Not a good, it's quite irrespective of what you may think about settlements, but if you wanted to see the process move, everybody needs space.
You know, Olmert and Abbas, they were talking about it. They were actually talking, okay, what's going to happen around Ariel? What's going to happen here? But I don't know, has the Prime Minister ever actually been clear about what the blocks mean, what would happen with places like Ariel?
Not.
And do you think he should be?
I think he should be. But so, that's my position. He had a meeting several weeks ago with the European Union's foreign minister, lovely person, Mogherini. Former Italian foreign minister. And she came out of that meeting very upbeat, and she said, I just heard more or less from the prime minister, that's what the spin in the paper was, that he's willing to go back basically to the former of Bush-Sharon. Israel's only going to build in the blocks and in Jewish Jerusalem. And I got very excited about this. I went on Israeli television, but I went on with a number member of the coalition from Habayit Yehudi, the Jewish Home Party, which also, it denies the difference between building in Gilo and building in Itamar. And I came out and strongly supported this approach, but my colleague from across the aisle, as they say in the Congress, was virulently against it and intimated that this would cause a coalition crisis if this was it. So you should know that this is not a position that, I don't know, I think it's widely accepted in Israel, but there are strong constituents in Israel that oppose it. But keep in mind, in April 2014, When John Kerry, the Secretary of State's peace process, collapsed, he spoke before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and he said, the Israelis built 700 units in a settlement and the process went poof. Remember this, the poof line? I spent 12 hours on Israeli television trying to find the Hebrew equivalent to the word poof. It's not there. Where was the settlement? Where did Israel announce the building of 700 units? In Gilo. Which no Israeli thinks of a settlement, really, across the board. No one thinks of it.
No Israeli Jew, maybe.
Maybe Israeli Palestinians, maybe. I don't even know where Gilo is, but you know, here, my kids grew up across the street from Gilo, right, in Talpiot, which was always part of Israel. They didn't think Gilo was 60,000 people. And so that's an argument that's very hard to make to Israelis, that this is a settlement and this stops the process. It's also, last point on this, it's an impossible demand to make of any Israeli leader, left, right, up, or down. Why? Explains this in the book. The West Bank has a certain status under Israeli law. It's not sovereign Israeli territory. But East Jerusalem, former Jordanian Jerusalem, in July of 1967 was formally annexed by Israel. It is sovereign Israeli territory. The Prime Minister of Israel has no more authority to freeze building in Jerusalem than the president of the United States has to freeze building in San Francisco. So it's an impossible demand to make. It ain't going to happen. And you can try to slow things down. You can try to give the Americans a sense of when these big projects are going to be announced. But if the prime minister tries to do that, he'll be hauled before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court will find against him. It's against Israeli law. So you have to be careful. If you're going into a peace process, don't make demands of the party that not only constrict their maneuverability, but which are impossible. And this is what happened.
Did you see a pattern when relations were perhaps getting a little bit better, though, between the United States and Israel, and then there would be an announcement of this kind of X number of units, and then the State Department would criticize, and then you'd have to get on the phone, and then there would be a cycle. So even
yes.
if what you just said is true, was there a sense that, oh my God, this is just repeating itself, and maybe we just need to figure out a way to avoid these kinds of clashes all the time?
I agree with you. Is that a question? I talk about in the book about some of these announcements about settlements. At the end of the book, and this doesn't get a lot of play in the press, it's not controversial, but the end of the book ends with a prescription. There's a couple of pages where I say, okay, you've now seen how we got to this point where, and not a particularly felicitous point in the relationship. How do we get out of here? How do we move forward? And among my prescriptions is that Israel, when it makes any decision, should always factor in what is the American interest, what is the American reaction, and how does this look through American eyes? Because the way superpowers see things is different than the way a small regional power see things. How does it impact the American Jewish community? We're going to talk about this later. And that doesn't always happen. I saw how it not happen. In one case I mentioned in the book where the United States stood by us in the UN and we repaid them by announcing, 1,000 units somewhere in the West Bank. It wasn't my happiest moment. And yes, it put us into another cycle. So I'm in no way absolving us in this book of responsibility. And that's my exhortation at the end of the book. Let's rethink how decisions are made in Israel. Not everything is domestic.
So I want to get to the heart of the book, which I think is really President Obama and your feelings about him. There's been some written about your psychoanalysis of him that you do by reading his own books. A couple of quotes from the book about Obama. Quote, I wondered about the ramifications of reconciling with a Muslim world. This was in advance of President Obama going to Cairo and making his speech. Widely opposed to Israel's existence, and whether Obama's desire to dissolve the lines of the tribe included my tribe, the Jews. In another part, you say, to an unrivaled extent, Obama identified American interests with the Palestinians. And you talk about tectonic shifts in policy under Obama. Another point, you said, the president's cold-bloodedness, while perhaps a plus in fighting terrorism, could also lead to browbeating us. So my question is, do you think that relations under President Obama are demonstrably worse than they were in previous presidencies? Because I know you know the history of fighting between U.S. and Israel. So I was confused reading the book about whether there's an exceptional nature to the tensions with Obama, or whether you really think it's worse than the past?
Okay, there's several questions in there. Let me unpack them. First of all, you made a lot of quotes, not all of them in context. Let me put it in context. Coming into this position as ambassador in 2009, at the outset of the president's first term in office, my first job is to figure out who we're working with. And the president wasn't very well known back then, not to Israelis, certainly, and I think to the United States even. I mean, he was a fantastically impressive candidate, but how deeply was he known? So my first job is to figure this out. So there's a section in the book called Obama 101. And since I wasn't a career diplomat, but a historian, I simply took my historian skills, tools, and set them to work to figure out who he was. So I sat down with everything he wrote, every interview he gave, and particularly the books he wrote about himself, and try to create a portrait of who he was and what his worldview. I'm trying to see the world through the president's eyes. And as I say in the book, I want to get to a point where we will never be surprised. At least I will never be surprised. And I saw this as my duty as ambassador. And you mentioned the cold-bloodedness. That's related to something that he describes in his memoirs. In his early part of his first term, every speech, he talks about his Muslim family ties. Today he doesn't, but back then he did. It's in the first inaugural address. It's in his first interview that he gave to a foreign television station, which was Al Arabiya. It was his first visits abroad, which were to Ankara and to Cairo. And it's there. He portrayed himself as a bridge. So it's a perfectly legitimate tool and question for an ambassador to ask, okay, how does this impact us? The book does say that if he can reconcile with Muslim populations in the world, this could redound to our benefit, but not if it's at our expense. And I think that's, again, a legitimate question to ask, an equation to pose for Israelis. He did come out quite frequently against tribes early in his term. Just recently, he was at my old synagogue in Washington and described himself as an honorary member of the tribe. But we had to think about that. What does that mean, someone who's against tribes? What does that mean? And people weren't delving into these concepts in very deep ways, but I had no choice. These are a matter of national security. Was he different than any other American president? Was he more critical of Israel than any American president? I have, the historical view. There was a famously strained relationship between David Ben-Gurion and Dwight Eisenhower. Eisenhower in 1956 threatened to sanction Israel over the Suez campaign. There was a strained relationship between Ben-Gurion and John Kennedy over the Dimona nuclear reactor. You want to look at some of these protocols, these meetings. I've read them all. Hard stuff were said. The relationship is not static. That's an issue. You can skirt it. You can write a fluffy book that's not going to touch on these issues, but I wasn't going to do it. I made a decision that I wasn't going to run away from any of these tough issues. And I did.
Well, it's an interesting section for people to read when they pick up the book, and they can make their own decision on that. Let's broaden it to the American Jewish community, which I know this is something that a lot of people are asking about in the cards.
Yeah.
What should be the role of the American Jewish community when it comes to Israel?
I think American Jews, if you're asking what they have a right to criticize, they have a right to criticize. And I spent much of my time going through synagogues in the United States, giving several speeches, one of which was called Israel and American Jewry, What Can We Expect of One Another? Hard question. What can we expect of one another? And on the Israeli side, Israel claims to be the nation state of the Jewish people, and I think it's about time we start living up to that claim. And not investigating whether how different people practice or don't practice their Judaism. We are the nation state of the Jewish people, or we aren't. And that raises all sorts of very difficult issues, difficult politically, by the way, for me. Israel, when it makes a policy decision, should take into consideration the way those policies impact the American Jewish community, because the American Jewish community is our hinterland. We don't have a hinterland. I don't know if everyone's Jewish here, but the American Jewish community is our hinterland. Let's not alienate our hinterland. Be a good idea, strategically. So I keep on going back in the book, I talk about issues like women of the wall and conversion issues, trying to convince Israelis who don't understand these reform and conservative women that they want to wear, tefillin and pray for Torahs. They don't get it. But I had to explain it to them in their terms. It's strategic. It's not a PR issue. It's not even a Jewish issue. It's a strategic issue. You want a relationship with the United States, you may not want to, arrest these women. I spent more time on the women of war. There's a whole chapter on women of the wall as a strategic issue. But what can we Israelis expect of American Jewry? What you can expect is that, first of all, respect our democratic system. You may not like the outcome of our elections, okay, but Israel's democracy is truly one of our greatest accomplishments. Again, I mentioned we're part of that small club of a tiny group of countries that have never known a second of non-democratic governance, but we are the only member of that club that's also never known a second of peace. And the fact that Israel is democratic is nothing short of miraculous, and that we have elections. And, especially the last 15 years with the rockets and the suicide bombers and everything we go through, it has a political impact. Understand us. At least you don't have to agree with everything we say, but at least respect our decision. One of the big problems I had in the book, and also with the Obama administration, was people saying, we understand Israel's interests better than Israelis do. That's extraordinary. They came to us during the Arab Spring when the Egyptians elected Morsi, and they said, well, democracy you have to express. You have to respect the outcome of a democratic election. Well, how about respecting ours? And that, I think, you can understand. And I expect American Jews to understand our geostrategic dilemma, which is that we live in a terrible neighborhood that is unraveling in our hands. That, yes, we can support a two-state solution, and I support a two-state solution, even though I don't think we have a partner, and even if that other state was created, what's it going to look like? It's a Palestinian state that has no democratic, has no institutions, no economy, and has an unelected corrupt leadership. I don't know if you know this, but last summer, Hamas tried to kill Mahmoud Abbas. Guess who saved him? We did. You want to pull out? You want them dead? You want the IDF to pull out? We're dealing with it. This is not an academic debate for us. This is reality. We can't have 100,000 rockets in the West Bank. Understand our history, what we've gone through when we withdrew from Gaza in 2005, drew from Lebanon in 2000, and got thousands of rockets fired at us. Understand that. That's all. You can still support a two-state solution. It's fine. You can criticize the settlements. It's fine. But just understand it. That's what we can expect of one another. And it was the most heartfelt, speech I could possibly give. I do believe we are one people. I do. That's the answer to that question. We are a rambunctious, creative, loud, sometimes impossible people. P.S., if anybody has any doubt that we are directly descended from the people of the Bible, just look at what Moses had to put up with. We're exactly those people. With Moses looking at God saying, what did you do to me with these people? We're exactly the same. So Knesset is like, and I desperately love the Jewish people. I talk about it, Freud would call it an oceanic love of the Jewish people. Just do. I want to preserve them. I want us to have that common dialogue, that conversation. Even though we occupy such different realities. Israel is a normal country, more or less, in a profoundly abnormal environment situation. I want to get to the questions, but I'm in Knesset, and I had this discussion. I'm one of the representatives on the Constitutional Committee. And we had a discussion about whether the state of Israel should give advantages to light industries in the settlements around the Gaza area. These guys have been shelled and mortared for years. And it should be an open and shut case. Of course we should give advantages to these people. But all of a sudden, various NGOs come in. Israel has a very deep civil society. And says, wait a minute. How do you define the Gaza area? It turns out it's seven kilometers from the Gaza border. What about someone who has a factory 7 kilometers and 3 meters from the Gaza border? Does he get the same advantages? What about the people up north? What about Kiryat Shmona? They've been also settled. Should we give the same advantages to Kiryat Shmona? And if we give the same advantage to Kiryat Shmona in the Gaza area, does the factory close in a lot? And what about the guy who has a factory in the Gaza area, but he lives in Tel Aviv? All right. And this debate is going on, and I'm sitting there with my mouth hanging open. Because this is a perfectly rational debate about a completely insane situation, about a population being shelled by thousands of rockets. Think about this. This is our reality. And that we've been able to remain that normal, that we can even have the discussion, please appreciate that. Just appreciate it. You don't have to agree with it. Just appreciate it. We should all, Israelis, Jews, and American Jews, pause, stop, and think for a second, just how incredibly fortunate we are to be alive at this moment in Jewish history. There's these two vibrant, large, successful Jewish communities in the world. Every Jew in the world today is free, which was completely not the case when we were kids. Think about that. And for just a minute, be very, very grateful.
There's a lot of questions about American Jewry here, naturally, and your love for American Jewry you made clear, but this questioner asks, I'm tired of Israelis judging American Jews as ersatz Jews. We aren't Jewish enough because we aren't real Zionists, because we live here. We haven't served in the IDF, no skin in the game, and we don't have the right to criticize Israel or its policies. We are good enough for your money, but nothing else, and yet when we try to tell Israel to buzz off, we are also told we're to blame. It's a bad deal.
I'm not going to take issue with it. It's an issue I deal with the book. Acknowledging this reality that in the book I say something very radical. I said we've grown in Israel accustomed to getting the support, often unconditional, of American Jews, particularly Jews whose form of Judaism we as a state don't recognize. And I don't think we can take that for granted. I don't think we should take it for granted. I think we have to work proactively to claim it, to change it. Yes, I think criticism of Israel is justified at times, but keeping in mind our reality. We criticize policies. I don't know what exactly about that part you want me to take issue with.
No, I'm just,
about the question.
I guess it's just I wanted that person's frustration to be able to be aired in the context of the conversation we're having. What does that mean, keeping in mind our reality? What happens if you're sitting here in this audience and you watched with fear the war last summer? Because you do care about Israel, and you care deeply, and you don't want them being shelled, but you're worried that this tactic, which has been tried before, to bomb Gaza, and is not going to achieve the objective, that they're still going to have their arsenal, that they're still going to have their tunnels, And even if he didn't care about the death toll on the Palestinian side, the Israelis sent the mighty IDF into, they became like a demolition crew to try and get, deal with these tunnels, and 66 Israeli reservists are killed in what was criticized as, described as really a non-planned war. Are you allowed, as an American Jew sitting in San Francisco, to express distress over this and criticism of that policy?
What's allowed mean? I mean,
we're
not the speech police in the state of Israel. You can say whatever you want in the Bay Area. Some of the things you say, I may say, wait a minute, we have a reality, as not to belabor the term, which is more complex. And I understand your discomfort, because every night we're being bombarded by bombs, by rockets. You're being bombarded by terrible images in your media, which is not easy either. I don't mean any way to belittle that. It's very difficult. I don't know where the question is going. Do they have a right to criticize Israeli policies as we conducted the war last summer? Of course, everyone has the right. The question, I'm asking what I can expect. What I can expect of American Jews, if you're going to criticize us, understand our reality and how complex it is. Think about how hard it is to be an Israeli leader in that situation, where you have members of your own government saying you've got to go in and conquer Gaza. If you remember the foreign minister at the time, Avigdor Lieberman, called a press conference, we've got to go in and conquer these guys. And you know, as a leader of Israel, what does that mean, conquering Gaza? And there was growing pressure on the government, by the way, for this. It still is. It means going in and fighting house to house and killing thousands of Palestinians, and certainly a great number of Israeli casualties as well, incurring the wrath of the world, being branded as war criminals. That's the choice. What's the alternative? You create a situation where you can have another Gaza war tomorrow. How would you like to make that decision? How hard is that? That's called sovereignty. And just all I ask is just appreciation, just how difficult that call is. How difficult it is to fight an enemy who is dug in behind its own population, using them as human shields, trying not just to kill Israeli civilians, but try to get Israeli soldiers to kill Palestinian civilians, because that is actually their goal. Because their goal is not, you know, they have a military tactic, but they have a diplomatic and media strategy, which is to delegitimize us. They want to get to a point where they can fire rockets at us, but we can't fight back because we have no legitimacy. That's what this is all about, by the way. And complex reality, but certainly you can say whatever you want. no one's going to come knocking on your door. This is not Tehran here.
Two political questions with a presidential election approaching. Would you prefer Jewish voters in the U.S. voting Republican?
I prefer Jewish voters in the United States to vote.
Another question. Jews in America overwhelmingly supported President Obama in the elections. Do you think they made the best choice based on the current state of affairs in the Middle East?
Well, I don't think most American Jews base their choices on what the status quo of the Middle East. I know from my own family. I have a very big family. I made Aliyah completely alone. I have almost no family in Israel, no close family. My family's here. Part of it in California. And I don't know of anybody in my family who voted Republican in 2012. And they care about Israel. They love me. I'm a nice guy. They have Israeli relatives. I asked them, okay, what were your choices based on? It's overwhelming. This is very interesting. What do you think their choice was based on? The composition of the Supreme Court. Yeah, everyone's going, yeah. And you've seen it in action this week, by the way. You saw it in action. So does that mean it's not a zero-sum game? They care passionately about Israel, but they also care passionately about the composition of the Supreme Court. And ultimately, that will determine their vote. And that's my family, whom I love and respect.
Yeah. Sticking with politics, how will Hillary Clinton be? Better for Israel if elected president?
I think that the book paints a portrait of Hillary Clinton, which is, I think, on balance, very favorable.
It was, actually. It was pretty positive, I thought.
Yeah, because I greatly enjoyed working with her. She's a formidable individual, powerful intellect, indefatigable. I don't know how she did it. But I want to say this. I'm not going to get involved in internal American politics here and say vote for this person or that person, but the issue is not so much Hillary Clinton as it is the Democratic Party, which is moving in a certain direction. We have to take stock of it and understand that if a Democrat is elected in 2016, Israel cannot expect to be involved. It evolved after 67 when Lyndon Johnson woke up one morning after the Six-Day War and said, oh, there's this little superpower out there that just defeated several Soviet-backed armies. We should have a military alliance with this country. And even then, differences over settlements. Truman never accepted Israel's capital in Jerusalem. But 1981, Reagan is condemning us for the Iraqi nuclear strike. But in the mid-80s, there's a change. There's really a threshold period, sort of mid-Reagan period. The very intimate alliance is born. And I talk about it's based on two principles, no surprises, no daylight. And that is carried on through 16-plus years of presidencies, the Clinton years and the Bush years. And we were aware that we had been sort of spoiled by this. We'd grown accustomed to this, this type of intimacy. And along comes a new man in town, President Obama, who comes into office with a different worldview, which is his prerogative as president to have a different worldview, but which includes, among other components, a collegial approach to international relations. America's not doesn't have to be the leader anymore. We're not the world's policeman. A heavy emphasis on international organizations like the UN that haven't always been so friendly to us. A strong emphasis on outreach to what President Obama called, even that it's a loaded term, the Muslim world. Reconciling with Iran right out of the gate. Reconciling with Iran. There's a country that wants to destroy us. And, as I said here, an unprecedented American support for the Palestinian issue in a way that we hadn't seen before. Because, remember, the first president to come out in favor of a Palestinian state was George Bush. But he had it in a sequential order. The Palestinians first had to democratize. They had to defeat terror. They had to end incitement against Israel. Then they would get the state. Obama more or less reversed the order. First they get the state, and then they democratize. For us, that was a very significant difference. You can agree with or disagree with it, but I had to deal with this. And I made policy recommendations to the prime minister on the basis of it. The book tells which policy recommendations were accepted, which weren't. But in Israel's predicament, in Israel's situation, this is our ally. This is the democratically elected head of our ally. Let's figure out what the world looks from his eyes. How can we accommodate ourselves, accord ourselves to the degree that we can? At the end of the book, I said, Israel's relationship with the United States should always be thank you, thank you. But every once in a while, we have to say thank you, but. Today, in the shadow of the nuclear negotiations in Vienna, this is a thank you, but moment. It just is. And we do it reluctantly, the but. I hope that's helpful.
Well, I mean, I think fundamentally what was puzzling to me is that you also identify a lot of times when Obama really did have Israel's back.
Yes.
Right?
I mean, why is that puzzling?
Because, tachlis, I want to get a handle on what he actually did that was, say, worse than some of these other spats. Was it a tonal thing? Mm-hmm. Was it the comment about, that you're apoplectic about in the book, or really about the when he talks about basing a two-state solution on 67 borders with swaps.
It was very severe.
Severe. Yeah. Although maybe we could talk a little bit about why that is so severe for the audience to understand it. You know, but I saw him, you know, with the Carmel fire, as you point out.
Moving passage, by the way, I think.
Yeah. It was when the Israeli embassy is under attack in Cairo.
Another moving passage.
Even when Israel is engaged in a war against Hamas in the Gaza Strip, and there are hundreds of civilians being killed. If I'm not mistaken, Michael, the Americans open up the stores of stored weaponry that they keep stored in Israel and resupplied Israel during the war. So
they delayed. Okay,
at the end of the day, they give them the weapons, even though they are the United States. President Obama is really getting hammered for supporting Israel during the Gaza war. So for me, fundamentally, I just want to be clear. I want to be clear about what you think, if Obama really is the most hostile president in America's history, or if it was worse before, again.
Are you going to hammer that?
It's not a fair question
for the very simple reason that the relationship isn't static. The relationship between Israel and the United States today is not what it was in 1956. It's not what it was in 1962. It's not even what it was in 1967. But by what we had grown accustomed to over the course of a Democratic presidency and a Republican presidency, it was a departure. And the president himself talked about, I'm making a departure. He says, I'm putting daylight between Israel and the United States. He says this. We had the principle of no surprises, which existed, by the way, that was my brief coming into the embassy. We have this long-standing tradition that if the United States is going to make a major pronouncement on Middle Eastern policy that impacts Israel's security, we will have a chance to look at the text in advance and to submit comments. And this existed for, what, 16, almost 20 years. And there was a departure. The president goes to Cairo. in June 2009 and makes a very long speech. It's actually twice as long as the first inaugural address. And it's full of issues that impact us, the Palestinian issue, particularly the Iran issue. The first time a president gets up and recognizes that Iran has the right to peaceful nuclear energy. But this is Iran that's seeking to destroy us. Now, those are very powerful pronouncements, but we had no forewarning of it whatsoever. You mentioned the 67 and border swap issue. Let me see if, without going into too much detail, I don't want to bore you. I know, can you be bored with this stuff? We spent many days, our negotiators, working out what's called the terms of reference. That's what you conduct negotiations on with Secretary of State Clinton. And the TOR, as it's called, is emblazoned on my soul. Here it is. The United States believes that through good faith negotiations, it can reconcile the Israeli goal of a secure and independent Jewish state with defensible borders with the Palestinian goal of an independent Palestinian state based on the 1967 borders with swaps. Now, for all sorts of reasons, it was very important for Israeli negotiators, and not just during this government, but in previous governments, that the 67 borders with swaps be placed in the TOR, the Terms of Reference, as a Palestinian goal. On May 18th, 2011, I was in the White House. The next day, the president was prepared to make a major statement about the Arab Spring. And I was heard rumors that there might be some part of it that would deal with us. And I went to the White House, I asked, I was told, don't worry, nothing there is going to be with you. And in the May 19th speech, the president of the United States made the 67 borders with swaps, took it from the Palestinian position and made it the United States position. I can spend an hour explaining to you why that was a big problem for us. But it really goes to the issue of trust and no surprises. And it, tell you frankly, it pertains to what's happening in the Iranian issue, because for the first time in my memory, I don't think there's much precedent for it, the United States negotiated 7 months secretly with the Iranians without telling us.
On why an do issue, you think that is? Why do you think they didn't do it?
Just keep in mind that this is an issue that just has a glancing importance for our national survival. Of course, I'm meaning that ironically. Okay. Now, that's unprecedented. That is unprecedented, and that is. And and you can try to sidestep in any way and sugarcoat it, but it is a true challenge for the state of Israel. Why is it? There are many reasons, and I don't absolve Israel from some responsibility. I had a certain approach which I recommended to the Prime Minister. It was sometimes accepted, sometimes not accepted. But at the end of the day, it really pertains to the president's worldview. He came out immediately in 2009 and said, I'm going to do this. And we shouldn't be surprised today that he's doing it. And we shouldn't be surprised that Israel objects to it. We do. And there are structural reasons why we object to it. You may notice that the United States is a big country. It's far away from the Middle East. It's not threatened with national annihilation by the Iranians. It has the largest military capabilities of any country in the world. Israel is a tiny country. We are in Iran's backyard. The Iranian regime toward us is genocidal. And while we have a very strong army, we do not have B-2 bombers, we do not have aircraft carriers, and so our margin for error on Iran is exactly zero. Zero. Understand this. We're talking about our kids' lives here. It's not about legacy. And we also have ideological differences, conceptual differences. The president has said, and it's wonderful, it's very easy for an historian to write about President Obama because he says so often what's on his mind. He says that Iran is rational. It operates on a cost-benefit analysis. Even though it's anti-Semitic, it's rational, though it's anti-Semitic, that Iran can be a responsible regional power, that it can even help resolve the Sunni-Shiite divide. These are all quotes. I'm not making this up. Israel, we see it as an irrational regime that is trying to obliterate us, not just in word, in deed. It's the world's largest state sponsor of terror. You will read in the book how they try to assassinate me. And that'll get you to get the book now. And in Washington, D.C., by the way, in downtown Washington, there's not a rational regime from our perspective. And so it is as deep a divide as you can get over Iran. Is it worse or better than anything that came before? It is different. That we have to say, but to say that it's different and not extremely challenging would not be to reflect the reality. It's very challenging. Indeed. Okay.
I was reading a little bit of history myself, and I Here's a historical quiz for you. Which Please. American president said this of an Israeli prime minister? The audience can guess too if you want. Boy, that guy makes it hard for you to be his friend.
Probably George Bush Sr. of or Clinton of Netanyahu.
It's Ronald Reagan, actually, talking about Begin during the whole AWACS thing when Begin was lobbying on the Hill to, and I looked at that when I was thinking about Bibi's visit, making his speech on Iran, which I know you opposed. Mm-hmm. But there were...
Not the content of the speech, the venue of the speech.
The venue, and I mean, maybe those are the that was the kind of part of the reason why the president didn't include him in some of these negotiations, which, and as you point out, Israel has the most at stake in.
I don't think that was that the negotiations had already been concluded by the
No, but I'm saying the kind of atmosphere, the point that Netanyahu, who knows America, went and gave that speech anyway. It got into, that was the culmination already of so much tension between them.
You're so right. You're right. I can't disagree with you. The book tells the story of how we got to that point. And what you may ask, what does all this have to do with the Iranian issue? The issue of trust is so, so basic here. And because trust is a matter truly of national survival for us, I'll just give you a small example that's happened in the last few weeks. The administration's messaging, as it's called, its mantras, beginning in 2009, was the United States has Israel's back, right? All options are on the table, and I'm not bluffing. And just about 2 weeks ago, the president gave an interview on Israeli television where he said there never really was a military option. So what does that mean? He was bluffing? So that goes to the essence of trust, which is not an academic question for us. And the book traces the crises of trust and the successive crises of trust that amount to the situation where you described, where the United States conducts negotiations without telling us on issues that are vital for our national security. But it's a long story.
So you don't believe that President Obama and his team are actually trying to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon? Or do you think that they're trying and they're just failing miserably with their approach? Because they're too
we
naive.
Do not believe that this deal, and by the way, I'm talking about, I'm in Knesset now, we agree about nothing, we scream at each other. If the seats weren't screwed down, we'd throw it at one another. The perception that this deal is exceedingly bad for the state of Israel is multi-partisan. I can point at just almost nobody within that 120-member body who thinks otherwise. Now, that's saying something. And here, so many former members of the president's own team have come out and say it's a bad deal. And five former advisors came out just earlier this week and said it's a bad deal. Robert Gates has said it's a bad deal. And people are quite knowledgeable. Alan Cooperman, probably the America's most knowledgeable person about nuclear physics, and these issues came out with the New York Times op-ed last week that said that this will give them a breakout period of a month, at the most. These are serious people, not just us. The difference is between the American advisors and Alan Cooperman is that our
Ambassador Dr. Michael Oren, although he's asked to be just called Michael this evening, is an American-born Israeli historian, military officer, author, and was Israel's ambassador to the United States from 2009 to 2013. In Israel's 2015 election, he was elected to the Knesset for the Kulanu Party. He has, of course, written two New York Times bestselling books about the Middle East, and his new memoir, Ally, My Journey Across the American-Israeli Divide, is an account of his time as ambassador and his insider's perspective on the relationship between America and Israel. Janine Zacharia, formerly the Jerusalem bureau chief of the Washington Post, is the Carlos Kelly McClatchy visiting lecturer at Stanford University. She will be in conversation with Michael tonight. Please welcome them both to Canbar Hall.
How's everybody doing?
Good.
All right. Welcome to the JCC. Thank you to the JCC for inviting me to moderate this discussion and sit with Michael Oren, who I've known for a long time. I actually have memories of sitting with you in 2005 on a rock in the Gaza Strip. You were dressed in your Miluim reservist uniform, guiding the foreign press about the disengagement. Do you remember that?
But what happened?
They disengaged.
We were sitting on a lawn.
Oh.
You can't make this up. We're sitting on a lawn, and there was a tree, which was an old
tree. The tree.
And all of a sudden, part of the tree collapsed and just missed us, which could be interpreted as divine intervention or divine dissension. But I've never seen anything like it. The tree just fell on us. You remember that.
I remember. Now that you mention it, I remember the tree. But I had forgotten it somehow. Yeah. I was a little distracted. It was a little bit of a busy time.
Yeah.
So let me talk a little bit about how this is going to work. I'm going to ask Michael questions about a variety of subjects, and let me just give you a sense of the scope of what I'm going to try and do. Michael's written a very incisive, I think it's fair to say now, controversial book, which I've read and marked up in the margins here, called Ally. I'm going to draw from it, but I want to use it to have a conversation not only about the past, but also hopefully be able to look forward in terms of, to use him as an analyst on American-Israeli relations. And to that end, we're going to discuss his critique of President Obama, try and, as we have a historian here, put that in some historical context comparatively. We're going to talk about Jews tonight. And we're going to talk about American Jews and how Michael sees the role of the American Jewish community. There are parts of the American Jewish community that he has a more favorable view of now after being ambassador than others, and that comes through in the book. Jewish journalists, which some of you may have read, has created a little bit of a stir, what he has said about Jewish journalists. We're going to talk about the Palestinians and the future of the peace process, Bibi Netanyahu. There's a lot to get to, is the point. And we're going to try and do that all and maybe try and solve the Israeli-Palestinian conflict.
About 2,000 years.
I don't know. Iran, don't forget Iran. Yeah. Something's going to have to give, but I'm going to try to get to as much of it as I can in the Q&A, and then I will be taking your questions and trying to get to as many of those as possible. Sound good? So, Michael, when I was reading your book, I was thinking about one word. I thought of the word disconnect. And I want to get your sense on my take on this, that there's a disconnect in the way Israel sees itself and the world and the United States primarily perhaps see Israel. And the disconnect is two versions of reality. Here's version one. Strappy little Israel, born out of the ashes of the Holocaust, threatened with another potential Holocaust by maybe an Iranian nuclear weapon, surrounded by an unprecedentedly radical, disintegrating Middle East, with only one ally, and maybe perhaps an uncertain ally, if we take your book as the way you've written it, that needs to do what it needs to do to defend the Jewish people. Okay, that's version one. Version two, and this is my read of it, so I want to get Michael to comment on it. One of the strongest militaries on the planet, Israel, backed by the strongest country in the world, is occupying another people, building settlements, very often fighting with this protector, the United States, publicly, which is something that a lot of people in America have been confused by, I think, and I want to focus a lot on that, and unable or unwilling to reach a peace deal with the Palestinians. So I see this as two different versions. And I'm sure there are people in the audience who maybe agree with one or the other, and frankly, it doesn't matter, but I think that there's two versions. Or both, maybe. Maybe there's a way to do both. But I think, for me, these two versions is what creates and underlies a lot of the tensions that you describe in your book, and I just wanted to use that as a starting point.
Fine. Terrific. Very good. First of all, shalom, everyone. JCC, San Francisco. Yeah. There was a time a couple years ago, 20 years ago, where I used to be—I would know or be related to just about everybody in this room through my wife, Sally, who, by the way, she says, when I chose this title, I knew it was going to be one word with two syllables. She said, well, you're going to have this, and everyone's going to say you left out the S. So for the record, I didn't leave out the S. So she appears rather prominently. I think it's an excellent opening question, the image of Israel, because I would take issue with some of the words you use. I don't think that Israel, occupies the homeland of the Jewish people. I do think we rule over 2.5 million Palestinians, and we can get to that later, what I think we should do about that. But I think both of those generalities, they're both right. Yes, the IDF is over twice as large as the British and French armies combined. It's the second largest citizens' armies in the world. It is highly motivated, technologically sophisticated, and yes, Israel faces threats that are not faced by any other government or country today. Thinking back through history, it's almost unparalleled. Because when the leaders of Israel wake up in the morning, they face 100,000 rockets in the hands of Hezbollah. And by the way, that's more rockets than that are possessed by NATO. And they can hit every city in the state of Israel, and we don't necessarily have a defense against all of them. We are facing, Middle East is unraveling around us. We face the situation in Gaza. We face delegitimization in international forum and an Iranian nuclear program, which is not one but several existential threats, all at the same time. And in our relationship with the United States, yes, and this is what the book is about, the ally, we have, in many ways, the ultimate alliance, where there's no substitute for America, for Israel, that just happens to be the world's largest military superpower, also the largest democracy, which happens to be our ally, which does provide us with essential security aid and stands up for us in international forums. Israel has no alternative to Israel, certainly not in the Middle East, because you have a country that's technologically and scientifically, certainly militarily robust. It has never known a second of non-democratic governance, which puts us in a very narrow category in the world, with like New Zealand and Australia and Canada. And a country which is unreservedly, unabashedly pro-American. We're not burning American flags in the streets of Tel Aviv. Really, there's no substitute. So we have together. And with that, as the book is very expressed in saying, we have divides. We have differences, sometimes very deep differences, over the peace process, over settlements, over the status of Jerusalem. And now, today, most poignantly, most publicly, Iran. And this book, which was supposed to have come out in October, November, which is when you publish nonfiction books, if you want to make a big splash. You don't bring out a nonfiction book in the beach reading season. The poor people at Random House, they couldn't understand why I wanted to bring out in June. I wanted to bring out June because of the Iran issue. I said, if you really want to worry about changing the name, you know, they all remember Jaws. Remember Jaws, 1970? That was the ultimate beach book. I said, we can change the name of the book to Jews. Okay? A little phylactery going, no one will go in the water while reading this thing. The answer is both, and I think you're right, Janine. I think you're right that this is the tension in the book, and it would give it part of its motive power, and as an ambassador, it's how I got all the gray hair, because it wasn't easy to span the divides.
And you yourself in the book seem to go back and forth a little bit. I mean, there are moments where you do acknowledge both of these realities. I think you do tend to favor more the first reality. I mean, you talk personally about growing up with facing anti-Semitism. You reflect often and regularly about the Holocaust. So those things are clearly foremost in your mind. You talk about when you want Israel to be perceived as the good guy, but when you put on a uniform, you know, you'll fight to defend the country and safeguard it. So talk about that tension for you, though, and how it played out.
It was intensely personal. Mm-hmm. We talked before, back in the green room, what it was like for me to go from being an historian who wrote in the third person to being a person who writes a memoir and has to write in the first person. And this is a very difficult transformation. Now, you said that you went through it, too. Writing in the first person, who are you? And how do you begin to separate your personal experiences and perspectives from a broader historical context, an overview? And for me, I'll tell you right now, it's difficult. I was in the military for something like 35 years, several wars. Our eldest son was wounded in action, shot by Hamas at close range. Sally, many of you know, lost her sister in a suicide bombing attack. We've been rocketed, we've been bombed. So the image of a beleaguered, besieged Israel is one that I've internalized on a very visceral level, you can imagine. Other aspects of it, the political delegitimization, what we do to help precipitate that, and we do things that do help precipitate it with some of our policies, and I've taken public issue with those policies, are much more abstract than, you know, seeing your son's bloody bullet-ridden uniform on the floor of the emergency room at Hadassah Medical Center. That's powerful stuff. I went to identify my sister-in-law's body. That's powerful stuff. That impacts the way you think. Last summer, while writing this book, I had to keep on running from my office into our bomb shelter in Tel Aviv because barrage after barrage of rockets are coming in.
So yeah, I want to spend some time, we're going to spend some time on last summer, especially since there are now rockets again, and I think we should talk about that. Mm-hmm. So one of the other things that I had in mind as I was reading it was the Israeli phrase, an old song, and it's a popular phrase, Ha'olam kulo negdenu. The whole world is against us. It doesn't matter what we'll do. I'm paraphrasing the rest. The whole world will be against us. Is this your outlook?
First of all, empirically, it's not true. When you say the whole world, even the people who say the world is against us, it's a very strange definition of the world. Does it include Western Europe or parts of Western Europe? Yeah. South America, parts of South America? Yeah. But it seems to me there's like 1.3 billion Chinese who rather like us, and just over a billion Indians who kind of like us, and between 70 and 74% of Americans like us. So the world is, you know, I think it's a rather narrow, how should I say, definition of what the world is. But I don't think that. And I also think that, yes, there are parts of the world that are against us and will remain sort of irredeemably against us. I think we have a real problem with Europe, and that's a problem that didn't begin with the state of Israel. It didn't even begin with Christianity. It actually predated Christianity and may now just post-date Christianity. But I think that we can take steps that will, in certain ways, you know, mitigate some of those policies that threaten us. Let's put a specific title. Our lives are at stake here. Ultimately, I think it's America. This deal is bad, not just for Israel. It's bad for America and the world. But that's our duty to say that. And
you agree that publicly, the way it's been said, it's constructive or not, or has it helped in some way, maybe? I mean, Bibi did give a very powerful speech on the Hill. I mean, so maybe it resonated with Congress, who you say in your book is Israel's ally. I mean, you go to Congress every time there's a problem with the executive branch. Mm. So maybe
it
wasn't
all negative. Or I can give you the flip side. Again, I don't want to give away all the great, you know, the exciting parts of this book. But the book also traces the way we cooperated with the president's policy on Iran. I'll give you just one example. In the late fall, early winter of 2009, the United States reached, preferred to Iran, a compromise formula known as the TRR formula. Don't you love this? TOR, TR. There's going to be a quiz afterward on all of this. TRR stood for Tehran Research Reactor. And the plan was to take the nuclear stockpile, the enriched uranium, that Iran had then, by the way, which didn't include 20%, it was only 3.5%, and ship it out to France and to Russia to have it processed to 20% and then sent back to a Tehran research reactor where it would be made into medical isotopes. Now, this was a risk for us. You know, Iran needs no nuclear isotopes. I don't know, they could buy them. It was a huge risk for us, and it was a bitter debate within Israel. Ehud Barak, the labor defense minister, opposed it, but Netanyahu accepted it. He went out on a limb. The Iranians rejected it, by the way. The Iranians rejected it. But I trace in the book the times when we went quite far out. The biggest example was the fall of 2012, days before the U.S. election, and there's a tremendous sense that Israel's going to act preemptively against Iran. This is where the gray hair comes in, folks. This was the toughest period, and it gets caught up in the election. And is Bibi going to order a strike against Iran and get the and somehow create the problem for the Democratic Party? And is he going to strike Iran to get the Mitt Romney to be elected president? All this is going on. And in the middle of it, what does Netanyahu do? He takes a drawing of a bomb with a fuse. I was there when he drew it. And he goes up on the General Assembly and he says, here's the red line. If they pass the red line, that's where we're in trouble. The red line was 90% enriched uranium. And I was in the room 10 minutes later when the president called him and thanked him ardently for giving him, the president, time and space to work out a nuclear arrangement. Now, that's called building trust. That was based on trust. Who violated the trust? He paid an immense price for that. Now, again, the situation is going to be very nuanced here. Everyone's going to try to make it black and white. Nothing's black and white in diplomacy, nor in human affairs. But that's a story. And you can't understand where we are today, Janine, without going through that experience. And that was traumatic.
I want to talk about the Jewish journalist part in the book, and I want to talk about Gaza, and then I'm going to move to some of the questions. I just want to read this one paragraph where you talk, I mean, you refer repeated throughout to a few different journalists, but mm-hmm. one point that you make is, the pinch I felt reading articles censorious of Israel sharpened into a stab whenever the names on the bylines were Jewish. Almost all of the world's countries are nation states, so what, I wonder, drove these writers to nitpick at theirs? Some I knew saw assailing Israel as a career enhancer, the equivalent of Jewish man bites dog that saved several struggling pundits from obscurity. Others seemed to disdain Israel the way upper-class American Jews of German ancestry once scorned the poor Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe, the Yiddish-speaking rabble who allegedly made all Jews look bad. Others, still largely assimilated, resented Israel for further complicating their already conflicted identity. Can you explain what drove you to write that paragraph? And if
Can't
you
imagine.
Really, truly believe...
Can't imagine.
You really, yeah. truly believe this?
Yeah. I not truly believe it. I'll stand by it. Listen, again, it's taken out of context. This was the hardest part of the book. There's a part of the book called We Are One with a question mark, because in my generation, I'm a bit older than you, we grew up under the logo of UJA, which was We Are One. And the book, 400 pages, took me a year to write. I took off 50 days for the Gaza war last summer to defend Israel. Those 4 pages took me an entire month. And I went back to them again and again and agonized over those 4 pages, our relationship with American Jewry. And there's also a section about relations with the press, but there's a bit of an overlap here. And here was the fact, and I think this is an irrefutable fact, and that is, if you look at the people who write in media today in the United States, there is a disproportionate number of Jews. Jews are very, very active in the American media. And I, in the previous paragraph, I talk about how anti-Semites are always saying how the Jews control the media, and that's why the media is pro-Israel. Well, the first part may be right. Jews are very active in the media, and I talk about all the Jews on the op-ed pages. The op-ed pages I liken to a loud mishpucha argument between various people on the right and left. Look at the people who have the columns. But the fact that Jews are very, very highly represented in the media does not mean that the American media is pro-Israel. And I had, again, this is a book that's going to touch on every tough issue. I'm not shying away from everything, but it's true, as a Jew, as an Israeli, every time there were these very critical articles of Israel written by an American Jew, it hurt more than it was a non-Jew. It just does. I'm just being honest here. And it is true that there are American Jewish journalists, and I'm not going to start naming names here, who make a point of saying, I'm Jewish, therefore I can criticize Israel. I'm not those guys. I'm not those settlers. I'm not those Likudniks. I'm different. And again, I think that's an unassailable observation. It's there. And it's something I had to deal with. It's just something I had to deal with as an ambassador, something I had to deal with as a Jew. And it was painful. I'm talking about pain here. You see it as criticism. I see it as pain. And I give specific examples of just some horrific things that were written by Jews in largely Jewish-edited journals. One of them, you know, this whole accusation that Israel or Israelis are the world's leader in human organ trade. Front-page issues. And also where these articles appeared. They're on the back page and the front page. Over the fold. And it's painful. I think it's, at some point, a great challenge for us, even to our security, but it's painful. And I have to ask myself, okay, what is it? What is leading these people, and you, with this, what you're reading here is an internal, I'm bringing my reader into my internal dialogue with myself. Why? Why is this happening? Is it because we make them uncomfortable? I mean, there are lots of countries in the world. Like I said, there are 194 states in the world. Most of them are nation states. Like 189 of them are nation states. What is it about the Jewish nation state that so upsets them? Later in the book, I talk about a correspondence that I have with my former college roommate, who's a very prominent Washingtonian and is very critical of Israel at times. And I asked him, all right, what bothers you more when Israel accidentally kills a Palestinian child, Israeli forces have accidentally kill a Palestinian child in the West Bank, or when American forces bomb an Afghani wedding and kill 24 people? What bothers you more? And if the former bothers you more, you've got to ask yourself why. You've got to. That's just being intellectually and spiritually honest. And I challenge a lot of people to answer that question differently. I care much more about the 24 Afghanis that our forces, the American forces, killed by accident than the Palestinian child that that Israeli force might kill. And my guess is, for a certain type of American Jews, that is more painful, is more problematic. I'll stop with this because we can go on forever on this. The chapter opens. I never read from my own book, but here, the chapter on We Are One ? Opens with me going to an art exhibit. Strange enough, it was one that was donated to me for my name at American University, and this 90-year-old woman comes up to me. And she says to me the following: I like you, but I don't like what your country does. And I said to her, Madam, do you like everything your country does? And she says to me, quote unquote, No, but your country must be perfect. And that starts this whole discussion about Israel and American Jewry. Do I sound emotional? It's emotional.
Well, I felt very emotional, too, reading it, because, you know, when I spent 2 decades reporting on Israel and the Middle East, and when I would travel, my name is Janine Zacharia, and people would always say to me, where are you from? Where are you from? And I'd say, oh, I'm from New York. I'm from New York, you know. And they'd be, no, where are you from? They want to know, are you Jewish? Are you Arab? And to me, it was not a relevant question.
This is in the Middle East, or
in the
Israel?
Middle East. Israel,
sure.
Too. They said, what is this name,
Janine? Janine Zacharia, Maze, could be an Arab Christian. Could be an Arab Christian.
Maze, what is this? They made fun of my name, you know. Do you know where this is? You know, and the Palestinians welcome me, you know. But I felt that, you know, I don't have a conflicted identity. I don't think Ethan Bronner had a conflicted identity. Isabel Christian doesn't have a conflicted identity. I don't think Thomas Friedman has a conflicted identity. And I think that a lot of upsets me is that what you've said in the book basically is that you cannot be a writer on Israel and be critical of Israeli or Netanyahu's policies without being deemed anti-Israel or in some ways a conflicted identity Jew.
Can you quote me on that? Because that is far from what I've said. What I've said is the following, and I say this openly in the book. Yeah, you know, American Jews who are Jewish and writing about Israel, you know, that's their job. It's fine. I point out the American Jewish writers who are going out of their way to single out Israel. And what I used to call, I used to use the name of a certain columnist in Washington who only wrote about domestic issues, only, except Israel. And then Israel only critically. Now, what is that? What is that phenomenon? Now, maybe you'd like me to ignore it, Janine, but I can't.
One example, Ruth Marcus. I mean, I think, you know, take a walk in the inbox of any correspondent on the Middle East who's written about Israel, and you get hammered from both sides. And what's dangerous about this, from my perspective, is by highlighting the Jewish ancestry of the writers, you're saying it's like a kind of weird anti-Semitism.
But it's not. You're attributing something I'm not saying. I'm talking about, now that you've mentioned Ruth Marcus, what we used to call it the embassy, the Ruth Marcus syndrome. I'm Jewish, therefore, yes, I usually write about American domestic issues, except for Israel. And in ways that are very challenging to us. And that's not anti-Semitic, it's just recognizing a fact. And, you know, Ethan Bronner, a good friend, but when Ethan Bronner's son went into the Israeli army, people in the New York Times wanted to fire him, wanted to take him away his job. You know, it's not me saying that. I have no problem with Ethan Bronner's son going in the army. I thought it was rather cool. It was the New York Times that had a problem with it. Whether he could be objective in reporting about Israel if his son's in the Israeli army. And you remember this debate. So don't kindly impute to me things I don't say in my book, but which I think I'm pointing out an unassailable reality. It exists. I know it's controversial. I know it's painful. There's a lot of pain in this book. But to take that and leap that into, I'm accusing these people of anti-Semitism?
No, but I'm saying there are a lot of people who say that Jews shouldn't be able to report on Israel because they can't be objective. And by highlighting it and saying that they, you know, the Judaism of it, I'm worried that it plays into actually other people's hands.
So you're having a Jewish problem with this. You're having a Jewish problem.
I never think of myself as as a Jewish American journalist.
But that's
I don't think that Thomas Friedman thinks. I think they think of them as
Thomas
analysts.
Friedman often talks about analysts. I'm a Jew, therefore I can say this. I mean, it's part of his his Weltanschauung, his worldview. And it is. And when Tom and I talk about my relationship here, when he writes a line that, you know, Netanyahu must know that when he gets the ovation in Congress, that is paid for by the Israel lobby. The ovation is paid for the lobby. That is a real problem. That you want to talk about anti-Semitism? That is touching on one of the oldest anti-Semitic tropes there is, and that is the Jews buy influence. That's what it is. And the book tells about how I got on the phone and begged him to take it back, and he wouldn't. And to me,